on the date of January 29th, 1996. Name of survivor, Alicia Appleman, maiden name, Jurman. Interviewer, Kathy Renner. City and state, La Habra, California. Country, USA. Language, English.
My name is Catherine Renner, R-E-N-N-E-R. Today is January 29th, 1996. I am conducting an interview with Mrs. Alicia Appleman in the city of La Habra, California, United States of America. Good afternoon. Your name, please.
My name is Alicia Appleman, and my maiden name is Jurman.
How do you spell your last name?
Appleman, A-P-P-L-E-M-A-N, and my maiden name, J-U-R-M-A-N.
And your name at birth, your complete name?
Alicia, and in Polish it is Alicia.
You have any nicknames?
Yes, from Alicia you can call me Ala, A-L-A, or Alusha, A-L-U-S-I-A.
What is your birth date?
May 9th, 1930.
And what is your age today?
65. I will be 66 in May.
And in what city were you born, and the spelling of the city?
I was born in a little village called Rosulna, R-O-S-L-N-A, and it's in the Carpathian Mountains in Poland. And from the age of 5, I lived in the city of Buczacz, B-U-C-Z-A-C-Z, and it's also in Poland.
And I would love to know about your family. What your family was like. What was your father like and his name?
My father's name was Sigmund Jurman, and he was a former officer in World War I, and he was born in Vienna in Austria. My mother's name was Frida, and she was born in Sweden. They spoke three languages at home, Hebrew, German, and Polish. I had four brothers. My oldest brother, Zachary, I was born in 1922. My second brother, Moshe, was born in 1924. And then I was Bunyo, and he was born in 1928. I was born in 1930. And I had a little brother, Herzl, who was born in 1932. When I tell the students when I speak in schools that we were a very active family. We lived in the mountains. My father built us a big house, put a pool around it, put a couple of drawbridges, and I felt like a princess. I had three older brothers who bossed me around, as older brothers do. I also had a younger brother whom I bossed around, as older sisters do. I remember my father telling me that he would have had as many boys as need be until he had his darling daughter, Alicia. Well, I was a very active little girl.
What kind of vacations did you take as a family?
We lived already in a vacationing home, so we actually received a lot of people. But in the summer, we used to go and berry picking, as far as I remember, when we lived in the mountains. But then when we moved over to Buczacz, I spent most of my vacations in my uncle's home, Dr. Kurz and Stanislavov. Because from the age of 5, I wanted to be a physician like my uncle, and so I spent my summers mostly there. And I, of course, we went to the river to swim, but most of my years up to the war, I spent my summers there and visiting my grandparents who lived in the mountains.
Could you tell me a little bit about your grandparents?
My grandfather Kurt's Opa, was born in Sweden, and he owned forests and lumber yards in Solotvina, in Nadvorna, in Rosulna, in Majdan, all in that area. He came before World War I. They had 16 children, 11 daughters and 5 sons, and they came to what was then the Austrian-Hungarian Empire because Grandpa needed 11 sons-in-law for his 11 daughters. He was a very wealthy man, but he was also a very kind man. I remember my grandfather used to, in the spring, when he used to get the lumber on the river, and he used to wave at us when we children stand on the bank of the river. And what I remember, when I was about 5 years old, in the wintertime, they mark the trees, the lumber that's going to be cut down. They had a big room, and then they had a fire in the center. My grandfather threw me over the fire for somebody to catch me, and I was so happy. I wasn't afraid at all. And then I remember one day he came to our house, and he says, Alicia, you see, take this little basket, take this little pen, and I want you to show me how you do wash your underwear. And I say, Grandpa, how can you say something? I say, I want you to do that, because one day you are going to be in charge of a big estate, and I want you to know how to do everything as well as the people who will be working for you. You know, he was a very lovely man. And of course, Grandma was a wonderful lady. I loved Grandma too.
And these grandparents and your uncle, Kurt, were they on which, from which side of the family?
My mother's. My mother is from the House of Courts.
If I asked you what incident best captures the memory of your mother, what would you tell me?
There were two things I remember very well about my mother. When I was about 7 years old, actually from the age of five, in our tradition for Shabbat, you bring food to the needy people. We didn't use the expression poor people, needy people. We shared, we didn't give. And since I was the daughter of the house, it was my honor to bring the food to the needy people. And I started like on Wednesday after Hebrew school. And one day my friend Rachel came to me, she was all excited. She says, Alicia, I have a secret to tell you. Could your maid bring the food in for this one Friday, this one, it was on Thursday, this one afternoon, please, could you ask your mother? So I came to my mother all excited, who doesn't want to hear a secret? And my mother sat me down and says, Alicia, darling, I would like to share something with you. She says, you know, God gave you the greatest of gifts, and that's the ability to make a decision. Now, you are going to make a decision today. You can go and bring the food to the people, or you can go and have your secret with Rachel. Whichever way you will decide, I will honor it. But the decision is yours. And of course, when I looked at my mother's beautiful eyes, I was going to bring the food and postpone Rachel. But this was implanted in my heart so deeply, because later on, during the war, when I saw people making decisions of killing us or any other decisions, or decisions I had to make, I was always sure that the decision is mine. I can make a decision. Whichever way I go, the decision is mine.
How did your family identify itself as being Jewish?
Well, in Europe, you know, you are committed, if you have the means, to be your brother's keeper. So you belong to an organization, you take care of orphans, you take care of old people, you are doing a lot of tzedakah, good deeds. And of course, we went to the temple, our holidays were very beautiful, and we children went to Hebrew school. We spoke Hebrew, we learned Hebrew from the very beginning. I think I spoke Hebrew from the cradle. And it was just something wonderful to be a Jewish girl and to go to Professor Fahrenhoff's Academy, Hebrew Academy, and to celebrate the holidays and to do good deeds. That was one of the important things, actually.
At the beginning, you told me that you were born in Rosulna and then you moved to Buchach. What was the reason for moving?
Our home burned down. And in Europe, if you have an orchard, you lay your fruit in long cases, wooden cases in the straw to ripen during the winter time. And the girl there was a mother and girl who lived in our house, we didn't have electricity there. So she went to get some fruit and she got it from the attic. She left the candle burning there and the candle tipped over into the straw, ignited, started a fire. But what really blew the house up is my father had a car which was parked on the foot of the hill, but the gasoline was on the top of the hill, and the gasoline blew up. And that was Friday night when my parents were in the synagogue, so the girl saved the children, saved us, but the house, in my father's business, everything was blown up. Just went very quickly. And I remember watching it.
And then you moved?
We moved to Buchach in 1935.
And what was life for you as a 5-year-old?
At the beginning, I was very lonely for the mountains. And at the beginning, we lived in a rented home, and then father bought us, he built us a home. And I made friends. I went to, in Poland, you go to a Catholic school because Poland is a Catholic country. But in the afternoon, I went to Hebrew school every single day for 3 hours, and I loved every moment of it. I learned how to read and write Hebrew. Of course, I learned all about the traditions. I was very proud of my heritage. And we made friends. Bucharest is a very lovely town. It has the river Stripa, and of course my brothers played soccer, and I was very deeply involved with them because I followed my brother wherever he went to the games. And we had friends. Life was very sweet for us. I was a very happy girl. I was a very good student in both schools, in the Polish school and in the Hebrew school. Of course I would have liked to see my father a little bit more because he traveled in order to make a living. But otherwise, I was very happy with my brothers and my mother and my father.
What was your brother's personality like, one by one, a little bit briefly?
Zachary was a musician. He was a violinist. He was a tall boy. He was blonde, blue-eyed. He took after my father. He was very kind. He loved children. And I adored my brother. I simply adored him. Then later when he was in school, he wrote to me, and when he came for the summer vacation, I was like following him around. He was like a father for me because my father wasn't there. Moshe had brown hair and brown eyes like myself. He wanted to be a forest engineer like grandfather. He was very good in chess. He was a scientist. He wanted to be a scientist. He was reserved, and he was very lovely. Now, Bunyo was like Zachary, but he was younger. And I loved him very much. And he was also a very good student. And Herzl, of course, was the one I bossed around. He was looked like my brother Zachary. He was blonde, blue-eyed, and a very good little boy. When my mother gave us chocolate, for example, and she divided it into two halves, I ate my chocolate quickly, and then I stood in front of my brother with a very unhappy face, and then he says, "Alicia, you want a little piece of mine?" And so I was a meanie. And he gave me half of his chocolate. It wasn't very nice to do it, but he was a very kind little boy. Very kind.
How did the non-Jews behave towards you at school?
Oh, this is a very interesting. I didn't really have problems because I didn't really know much about anti-Semitism until I was 8 years old. And my brother came back from the Conservatory of Music very badly beaten. They beat him up, destroyed his violin. He went to the Conservatory of Music in Lvov, which is now Russia, and you spell it L-V-O-V. And that's when I found the first time about anti-Semitism. But I had a very good friend, and her name was Slavka. She was a Ukrainian girl, and we became very good friends. When I first came to Bucharest, I was looking for skiing and for a little hill, you know, in the city there weren't many hills, and I found this wonderful little hill, and I was skiing down, except this hill had one disadvantage. It went straight into the main street. So if you skied, you really had to brake not to get into the farmer's sleighs. You could get yourself killed. And as I was turning back to go up the hill, I saw a skier without ski poles just going down like that, and I knew she was into trouble because she didn't sound like an experienced skier. Well, she went down that hill, and I made myself a shield, and I caught her. So we fell over, and then a sleigh passed us at that time, and so the farmer was very angry, and he gave us a couple of switches. And that was Slavka. The reason she went down the hill, her cousin challenged her. And she was about 6 years old, and we became very good friends.
Going back to the incident of your brother, how did that affect you?
It affected me very deeply. I was very shattered because I could not understand anybody hurting my brother because he was such a wonderful and kind boy. But what happened is after when he came home and he was healed, my father took him into the meadow and trained him how to fight. Really trained. And you know, I followed for a whole week. I was not in school. I hid in the bushes and I watched my father train my brother. And I picked up a few good points. And so when he went back for the school year of 1938, he wrote a letter to my parents telling her, telling them that he was fine. They fell upon him again, but this time he knew how to defend himself. And he left them a couple of good punches just to remember him by. And he wrote a letter to me, "Dear Alicia, I hope you didn't get into too much troubles with your teacher when our father trained us." So he knew I was there.
You said that was the first encounter with anti-Semitism. So how did that change? How?
It didn't make any difference between me and my teachers, or between me and my friend Slauka, or my other friends. But I did have one problem when I was in the fourth grade. We had a math teacher, and she was quite anti-Semitic. Whenever she called the Jewish students to the blackboard, she intimidated them. They knew the answers, they knew their math, but they got so frightened, because at my time, the teacher used a ruler to hit the children on their hands. So I used to whisper the answers to them in Hebrew. And the teacher finally found out that she expelled me from my class. So my friend Slauka said to me, "Alicia, why don't you teach me the numbers in Hebrew, and I will whisper in your place." But later on, since she was doing something wrong, she had to go to her priest and tell him about it. So I went with her, and I waited outside the church until she gave her report to the priest, and he forgave her. But she was so wonderful. She felt so. So one day we had the holiday of the trees, like Bomer, and she came carrying a little tree. She also wanted to plant a tree. So we took her along. Children don't know hatred. Children just know love.
What was the last Jewish holiday you spent as a family?
The last Jewish holiday, it was 1941, and that was, I think my father wasn't alive. It was the high holidays, Rosh Hashanah and Yom Kippur, but I don't think my father was alive at the time. We didn't have the synagogue open anymore. The Germans were there already.
You said the Germans were there already. What year did that happen?
1941.
When did the Germans come into
the church? They came September 1st, 1941. And no, they came June 6th. The German came in the summer. I think June 6th, the summer of 1941.
Before getting into that, could you tell me about a couple of years before that? What was your life like?
About the Russians, when the war started? The Russians came to us in 1939. The Second World War started in 1939 when the Germans invaded Poland, but the Russians also invaded Poland. So they divided Poland into two halves. Western Poland fell under the German occupation, Eastern Poland fell under the Russian occupation. So when I was 9 years old, the Russians invaded my hometown. I remember it very distinctly. I went to the city, the center, to see what was happening. And I saw very happy soldiers. You know, the Russian soldiers were very happy, very friendly to the children. They gave us little enamel stars, red enamel stars, and I collected some of them and brought them home. But what they did, however, they closed our Hebrew academy. So we had to go underground. Then we moved our Hebrew studies from home to home. Our parents had to stand watch so that we shouldn't be found out by the Russian police. They would have taken the parents, probably everybody, to Siberia. I went to the Russian school for 2 years. What happened to me there, however, was very painful at one time. I was a very good student, and if students finished the school year with excellence, they got a diploma, which was in Russian, he said, Naharojena Gramotoyu, with this particular diploma, which had Stalin's and Lenin's picture. And when we had the assembly at the end of the school year, the teacher mentioned my name. Yes, Alicia Jurman is entitled to the diploma, but because her father is an enemy of the Soviet Union, she cannot get this diploma. And I was shamed in front of the whole school body. I couldn't get this diploma because my father was an artist, but he was also a businessman, so I wasn't given this diploma. I tried to study and tried to do my very best, but I was considered, you know, through my family, that we weren't quite what you would call kosher. We had a passport for 3 months, renewable each 3 months, and I believe they would, the Russians would have sent us to Siberia if it were not for my uncle. They needed him at the hospital as a physician, and he claimed us as his family, so they let us stay in our home.
How do you recall what was going on in the streets the day the Russians came to your town?
I think a lot of people, I remember, we stayed home, but there were some people who went to welcome them. There were people who belonged to the Communist Party in our hometown, and they came to welcome the Russians. I didn't consider them, my parents didn't consider them dangerous as somebody who was going to do any harm to the Jewish people in particular. But of course, my father was aware what communists are like. But we children, I didn't know much about it. I only knew that I would have to learn a new language. And we learned Russian. And we didn't have books at the beginning. The teacher gave us written pages and we had to understand what she was writing. It was not a very happy time because unfortunately our tragedy started already under the Russian occupation. You see, the Russians encouraged students to study in Leningrad. They opened a special institute there. And my brother Moshe reasoned if we were to study in Russia, maybe it would protect us from being exiled to Siberia. And of course there were arguments at home because my parents didn't want them to go, but eventually he won them over. He went to study to Russia, but the conditions were so bad there that he escaped. And when he came home about 3 weeks later, the Russian NKVD came to our home, arrested my brother, and took him to prison, not in my hometown of Buchach, but about 30 kilometers to the city of Chortkov, which is spelled C-H-O-R-T-K-O-V, and he died in prison there very soon. So the tragedy started already there. And he was only 15 years old. They kept him in prison so that he couldn't tell other boys what that school was like in Russia. But he didn't commit a crime. He was just homesick.
Do you recall the day they came to get him from your house?
Yes, they came to get him. It was 1941, 3 weeks after he came home.
Could you describe to me what he said and what he was like the day he came home?
Oh, he looked very bad. He was starving. We sent him packages, but they didn't give it to them. And then besides being in school, they were also working on farms. So he was very desperate to get home, and he wasn't feeling well. He was quite ill. But he didn't have any special disease like tuberculosis, which usually a youngster like that would get. He was just exhausted. I don't know how he got home. I never heard the whole story. But the time when they came for him, it was a terrible night, of course. The NKVD, as we know them now as the KGB, any criminal acts they committed or arrested was always the middle of the night to frighten people and to bring them into shock. But my father followed my brother and went with him to Chortkov and pleaded with them to let him go. He wouldn't say anything, not a word. But they didn't trust him. So he had to pay with his life. You know, he, as I mentioned before, he was a very good chess player. In prison, he made chess figurines out of bread. And so the commander of the prison sent us a letter in these figurines and says, had my brother lived, he would have been a chess champion.
How did your family find out about his death?
They let us know from the prison commander wrote to us. But they wouldn't let us bring him home for burial. He had to be buried there. It's ironic because I was later, under the German occupation, imprisoned in the same prison and thrown to be buried at the same cemetery when they beat me to death. And I was thinking at the time that my brother Moshe is buried here someplace.
Could you tell me, I'd like to know what your parents decided to do after that?
You know, it's interesting because it seemed like the light went out of there. My father had so much beauty, so much light, and so much joy in his eyes, and so did my mother. But some kind of, like a film came over their eyes. There was laughter then, but not quite the way it used to be before. I imagined and I understood that losing a child was the most horrible thing in a parent's life. They tried to be, you know, still we tried to continue our lives in keeping a semblance of normalcy in the house because there were still four other children. But I could see, even when my father smiled, when they listened to music, there was always some sadness that settled into their eyes, into their hearts, which was projected through their eyes. It wasn't quite the same.
And what happened then?
And then, of course, in 1941, the Germans broke the treaty with Russia, and they attacked Russia. And the Germans came into my hometown. And, you know, I remember it very distinctly. Whatever was happening in other parts, and our town was very quiet when the first Germans showed up. Later on, of course, there was a great welcome for them. But I remember it was very quiet in town. And then I went to the center to see what was happening because I was a very curious girl. And I saw a cannon with six German soldiers roll from the side of the street into the center. And, you know, I stood looking at them. And I say to myself, God, is this the German might? What can they do with six soldiers and a cannon? You know, I was 11 years old, and this is how I perceived them. I didn't know what is going to follow. But very soon after they settled in, they asked all men from the age of 18 to 50 to come to the police for a registration. And my father fell under that age category, and he went to the registration. We were expecting him home for dinner. But my father didn't come home that night. He didn't come home the following day. And then rumors started flying all over the ghetto that 600 leading citizens who were detained at the registration, because some of them were let go, were taken into the forest and massacred into open graves. For me, it was very difficult to accept that my father was just shot. You see, my father was a hero in World War I. He saved 38 high-ranking officers, German officers, from the Russian Cossacks. So I thought maybe my father tried to escape. Maybe he was wounded while escaping. So I went into the forest looking for him, calling his name a whole day. And then I was very tired, and I fell asleep at the edge of the forest, and my brother Zachary found me. He lifted me into his arms, and he said, Alicia, our father is not coming home. I was 11 years old, and that's when my childhood stopped. And my father never came home. You know, in 1967, I was asked to come to the German consul.
If you can tell me about that later, and if we could continue. Did your father and your mother ever try to leave Poland before these things happened?
My mother was a Swedish subject. She still had her citizenship. It wasn't that easy to leave Poland because we were such a big family. My grandfather sent a lot of money to Switzerland to get to the Swedish consul to get the whole family out. But you can't, only a few people left. The whole family had to leave together. And people wouldn't really have let my grandfather go. He was supporting so many people. He was in charge of so many people. I don't really know what went on, but I know they tried to get out. During the Russian occupation, they couldn't get out. But when the war started in 1939, they tried to get out. But it isn't just getting out. The question is nobody would let them in. I'm constantly asked, how come a family like ours didn't get out? To get out, you have to have some place to go. And the countries closed their doors to us.
We're going into tape two now. with Mrs. Alicia Appleman. You were telling me how even if you wanted to leave, you had nowhere to go. And I also would like to know what happened to your father's business during the Russian occupation and then during the German occupation.
The Russians, my father was a partner in a factory which manufactured fabrics, and that was in Bielsko. So Poland was occupied, Germany occupied Bielsko in 1939, so he lost his business. He had some fabrics which he had to give up to the Russians. But it was amazing. Of all things, they let my father manage a China store of fine china, which was imported from Czechoslovakia. I was very amazed. He was a very fine manager, so they let him do that. And whenever I came back from school in the afternoon, I came over to my father. My father taught me how to identify fine china. So he worked in that store, and this is how he made his livelihood. But we had to give up most of the fabrics that we had at home to the Russians. This is how he supported us.
And then during the Germans?
During the German occupation, my father died within the first few weeks of the occupation. The only way we could live is if we sold things from the house. But what happened? The Germans took over homes when they came into my hometown, and one of the homes they took over was ours. But they really came to take some artwork, pictures that we had, very fine pictures in our home. My grandfather's brother was an art collector. He lived in Holland. He was a shipbuilder and an art collector. He supplied all these pictures to our family. But they saw it was such a lovely home, so instead of taking the pictures out, they threw us out of the house.
Could you describe that day?
That was about 4 weeks after the Germans entered my hometown. It was a terrible day. I wanted to take our album, but the German pulled it out of my hands. The pictures spilled, and he stepped on them. And I wanted to say something. My brother stopped me because he would have shot me right there and then. And you know, for many, many years, I could not put pictures in albums. I had such a memory, such a painful memory. And then we moved over to a different house, what later on turned out to be the ghetto. And so we lost our home a very early time. And we lived in this. We had two rooms, and then we just lived in one room. Ours was not a closed-in ghetto. Ours was an open ghetto. They weren't barbed wires or anything. It ended at the main street. You could go to the main street, and this is it. You could not cross the main street. They, of course, didn't give us any food. We didn't have any food rations at all. The only way you could get any food is to take some of your clothing to endanger your life, take off the Star of David, go to the market and trade it there with the farmers. And of course, we children realized if our parents were to go out, they would be caught and killed. So we organized a chain, kind, and we children went out to the market and we traded for food. And many of these children were caught and they were killed. And you know, I want to tell you something, that I have never seen such brave children in this world as the children in our ghetto. I call them the little stars from the kingdom of darkness. They were indeed little stars. They left us a beautiful light, a light of bravery. Children, you know, some of them were as young as 6 years old.
Can you recall an incident?
Yes. I know of one little boy who was caught and he was killed.
Did you see it?
I did not see it with my own eyes, but what I did see with my own eyes, my young cousin, my father's cousin, who was about to give birth, was very close to give birth, she went to the market with her little five-year-old girl, and she was caught by a German. And she was killed right there. Actually, he slit her stomach open, and he bayoneted the little girl. That I saw with my own eyes, and I testified against that murderer in 1961. I was living in Florida. I saw it with my own eyes. And children just disappeared.
What did you do after that happened?
I didn't tell my mother at all. I had terrible nightmares. Terrible nightmares. I still have terrible nightmares. But I continued going to the market because our life depended. There was a man who was manufacturing soap. So I was taking the soap from him, selling the soap for the same price I paid him, but I asked the farmer to give me a piece of bread. You see, at that time, my brother Bunyo was taking to a camp, and we had to send him some food, and the only time I could get any bread is when I sold the soap and I got a piece of bread in addition to it.
You said your brother Bunyo was taken to a camp?
Yes.
When did that happen?
They came into the ghetto and they gathered up about 60 young boys, 15, 16-year-olds, and they sent them to a camp called Borki Vielki. Now, this was supposed to be a camp, a work camp, and it was a work camp. But one of the boys escaped. And then they took all of the boys, and they asked them to make a circle. And they counted to 10, like 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10. And they shot every 10th boy. And my brother Bunyo was the 10th boy. And I found out, and I had to tell my mother. It was truly devastating. It was a terrible thing. I remember crying for my brother nights and nights crying for me. But it was also a point where I swore to myself that if I lived, I shall protect my mother and my little brother with my life. Because we had already, at that time, lost Zachary.
Talking about Zachary, you said, what happened to him?
You see, after there was one action in our hometown where they fell upon the homes, they took people to the railway station and put them on a train. I was taken in this action. I was playing chess with two boys, a boy 10 and 11. I was at the doctor's home. Their father...
What year was this?
That was 1941.
What month?
It was November, I believe it was. And that was the first action, the first time they took people away. The only time they never took people to the railway station again. They fell upon this house, and I remember the door flew open. We were playing chess. The door flew open, and two SS men walked in, and they gave a command, everybody out. Now, the father of these boys, they were refugees from Germany. He was a physician, a family friend, realized what was happening. So he went over to one of them, and he begged him. He said, this little girl is not my daughter. Please let her go. But he wouldn't hear of it. And they pushed us out. And then they pushed out. I saw other people being pushed out of the homes. And then the beatings and killing started. Those who survived were taken to the railway station. There was a freight train waiting for us there. And there were soldiers, German soldiers. You know, we call them now Nazis. I had never heard the word Nazi. To me, they were soldiers who came to kill us. There was the SS, there was the Gestapo there, the police, with dogs. And then they let the dogs loose on us. We had nowhere to go but inside these freight cars. And they locked them from the outside, and the train took off. After a while, I heard some commotion inside the car. You see, European freight trains have windows. Later on, when the Jews were taken, from what I have learned in history, to concentration camps, they had barbed wire, but not in our cars. So the men... adults apparently realized that if they could spread the bars, they could throw some children out, maybe save some lives. So the father of these boys turned to me and said, Alicia, you're next. And this is what they were doing, throwing children out through this window. He says, Alicia, you are next. And I said, what do you mean I'm next? What about your own sons? And then he looked at me, and I'll never forget the look on his face. He said, I swore to save humanity, but humanity has gone insane. And you are next. And I didn't even have a chance to say, I want to go, I don't want to go. He just picked me up, handed me into a man's arms and called after me, roll, roll, follow the trucks home. And then another man picked me up and I was pushed through that window. I was flying there for a second or two, and then I suddenly hit something very heavy. And then I don't remember exactly how I came home. I remember the river, and he told me, to follow the tracks home. So I remember that I was walking on the tracks, and I was, and the train turned around that was trying to catch me, and I was screaming and screaming. You see, I did get home. I was unconscious. I had I hit my head. I had a concussion. I was unconscious for a whole week, and then I finally woke up. Another, my brother Zachary told me that another little girl also returned, but she died of internal hemorrhaging. I, at the time, we had absolutely no idea where the train was going. There wasn't any other train from my hometown ever taken again. But I was the only survivor of what later on became known to us as actions in German, Aktionen.
And you don't recall how you got home?
Or
how
I remember long it took? I remember the river, I remember talking to somebody, but I don't remember. I had a concussion, so I must have been, the train wasn't very far from our home, that is true too. But I don't quite remember. I remember following the tracks, but I woke up after a week, that's all I remember. But I do know how they threw me out through the window. And of course, later on, my brother told me that most of the children who were thrown out of the window were shot in flight because the Germans saw them being thrown out through the windows. They must have been doing it in other cars as well.
Did this incident happen before your brother Bunyo was taken away?
Yes. That was the first action. And that happened, and my brother Bunyo was taken away in the beginning of 42.
So first your brother Moshe, then your father?
Yes.
And then Bunyo?
Then Bunyo, right.
How did your mother take all this?
It was devastating for my mother. She tried to be brave. And I had to give her the news also about Zachary, what happened to Zachary. I had to give her all this news. It was terrible, absolutely devastating. But she continued, you know, showing a face for us, but at night I could hear her crying. She was a very, now that I am a mother myself, I realize her pain. Devastating. She was extremely brave to be able to care for us altogether. Not only did she care for us, but my mother picked up children in the ghetto whose parents were taken into an action, and if the children survived, she brought them to our home. She cared for other children as well. She was a very kind lady.
What did you take to the ghetto with you?
I took to the ghetto very few things. Some of the things that my mother took, my father at that time was not alive. Yeah, my father was still alive. My brothers took, but I took some sketches that I made and with me, and some books. We knew already that there were rumors that there's going to be a ghetto. But we were thrown out suddenly out of our home. They sealed our home, but I think my mother and my brothers went back to take some of the things out. But I don't know of it.
So when you moved to the ghetto, you still were a complete family?
Yes, when we moved to the ghetto, we were, because they threw us out of our home. It wasn't exactly that we moved to the ghetto at that time. It just happened to be that this part turned into the ghetto. We had to move out of our home. They threw us out of our home, so we moved to a new place. But at that time, it wasn't a ghetto yet. It turned to be a ghetto later on. This house fell under this area of the ghetto. But we were evicted from our home because the Germans wanted our home.
So how long after did the incident with your father was taken away?
Let me see. I think my father, to be very correct, I think my father wasn't with us then. Right, my father wasn't with us then because my father was taken away about 3 weeks after the Germans came in. So it was, my father wasn't, my brother Zachary was then in the room when the Germans came, yes.
You mentioned before that your brother Zachary, something also happened to him.
You see, the when, young...
When was this related to the time you moved into the ghetto?
That was at the beginning of 1942.
Are there other incidents that come before that that you'd like to tell me first?
1942. We had the action, the 600 men were killed in our hometown. The train left my hometown in 1941, and then we went into a miserable winter of 1942. And the young people...
Excuse me, you were living in the ghetto still?
Yeah, we were. That is when the ghetto was being formed, in 1942. But we were living there because we were evicted from our home. So we were living, even before the ghetto was formally declared, we were living already in that area. The young people did not take all of the German occupation lightly. They were organizing. They knew that eventually they will have to organize a resistance. And so my brother Zachary and his friend started organizing. I don't think they could get hold of any ammunition. But what they could do, however, is have information whenever action will start and whenever people went into hiding to protect the people when they were hidden. And so my brother and his friends, whenever the Jewish people, because we knew that trouble was starting, and people who had friends, farmers, or anybody who lived in villages, they gave all they had, and the people promised to hide them. But after a while, they took everything they had, and they told them they were taking them to a safer place, but instead they took them order to police, the police killed them, or they killed them themselves. And my brother and his friends were aware of this, and then they went to the farmers and they burned the farmer's barn or beat the farmers up so that as a retaliation, so that the people should, who were hiding Jews, should get a message that you can just, you know, betray them. And one day he heard of a family which is going to be betrayed, who had four children. So my brother Zachary went to bring them back into the ghetto because it was better for them to be in the ghetto than to be killed by these supposedly protectors.
Did he tell you he was going to do this?
No, I found out from his friends how he died later on. But I did not see it myself. But I know that my brother was caught and he was hung. He was betrayed by a Polish boy who was an intermediary who was supposed to be helping out. Because my brother was missing from home for 3 days. Sometimes he was missing for half a day or a day, but he was never away for 3 days. And so I went looking for him everywhere, and I couldn't find him. And then towards the end, in the afternoon, I came across two boys and two girls who were standing on the street, and I heard one of the girls say, "Here comes his little sister, here comes his sister." And I found out, I asked him, "What about the little sister?" One of the boys stepped forward to say, "Alicia, I will tell you. I'll take you to your brother." And we passed the bridge, and we came to the prison yard, and there was my brother hanging. And I sat near him, and the Ukrainian policeman came out and pulled out his gun and put it to my head and said, "Ya tebe zastrelyu, I will shoot you." And I say, "Strelyaj, shoot." And the following day, he took out the gun and put it to my head, and I said, "Go ahead and shoot." I don't know why he didn't shoot me. But in the evening, when the policeman went into the prison, my brother's friends came. We cut my brother down. We brought him to the cemetery. I didn't even let my mother know because my brother was mutilated. His hands were broken. And we buried him. And I swore on his grave that if I lived, I shall tell his story and the story of many brave boys and girls who fought very valiantly the way they knew how to fight. And I have literally dedicated my life to telling their story.
So before being hanged, your brother was also tortured?
Yes. But he never revealed anything because no one was ever arrested. Because they knew that my brother belonged to a resistant group, but he never revealed anything.
Who hanged him?
I don't know, sweetheart. Could have been the Germans and the Ukrainians together. But there he was, hanging in the prison yard.
What happened then?
I had to tell my mother. It was devastating. That is, and then, of course, my brother Bunyan. My brother Zachary was the first to go, and then Bunyan. And then just my mother and my little brother were left. And I swore on my brother's grave that, and I promised myself that I will protect my mother and my little brother with my life. If anybody has to die in the family, I will be the one to die. But I am not going to watch my mother or bring her news of another tragedy. There were actions during that period of time. And then in 1942, in the winter of 1942, it was the beginning of December, I remember we lived in a little house of about 16 people, and the only clothing available to all of us was my mother's shawl, her jacket, and her shoes, and I put them on, and I went to pump some water for our household. And I just came in and put the pails down in the hall. I was about to enter our room, and suddenly the door, there was a knock on the door, and the door flew open, and a Ukrainian policeman entered. And he had a yellow pad in his hand. He called my mother's name, Frieda Jurman. And you see, I was all bundled up and a tall girl, and I said, yes. And I bolted and I started running, and he called after me, hey, where you are going, you shouldn't be running. But you see, I had to run. I had to get this policeman away from the house because my mother was in the room there. And I ran all the way, and then finally, when he locked me, because he thought he had Frieda Jurman, he locked me in the prison cell, I said, thank God. The prison cell was filled with mothers, and later on I found out they had taken fathers too. And so in the early morning, around 5 o'clock, they took us out of the prison cells into a room, and there was a policeman sitting behind the desk. He had a yellow pad, and people passed in front of him. They had to give their names, and he registered them. My turn came, and I gave my name, Alicia Jurman, and the policeman lifted up his head and said, Alicia, what are you doing here? This is not for children. They are going to take you to a terrible place. When the Germans come in, go down on your knees, beg for your life. Maybe they will let you go because you are a child. But as he was talking, I was getting angrier by the moment. Do you know who he was? He was my friend Olga's father. He was the man who, when I went to pick Olga up to go to school with her, he hugged me and kissed me. He said he loved me like a daughter, and I loved them like a father. But here he was sitting, this traitor, not just registering us. But you see, he was a Ukrainian policeman who came with the Germans into the ghetto to kill us, to take us to the graves. And my heart just froze. Kind of a darkness settled into me, and I stood against the wall. And then they came. You have seen them on television in those green uniforms. To me, they look like angels of death. And I say to myself, never. I will never go down on my knees. I will never beg for my life. I would rather die as a proud Jewish girl. And I stood there, and Olga's father realized that I'm not going to beg for my life. He jumped up and just smacked me over the face. And then they took us out. It was still dark outside. They had sleighs waiting for us. They put us on the sleighs, and the Ukrainian policemen sat around us with their guns in our bags. And when we left the prison yard, I knew if we are going to go to the right, they will take us to the feather in the forest and kill us where my father died. But they took us to the left, and we passed the bridge. We came to the center of the city, and I looked up where the ghetto was. It was on a slight hill, and I started to cry. Because suddenly I realized the anguish my mother must be feeling in her heart. when she saw the pails of water, but where was her daughter? And you know what I wished that morning? I just wished that the sun wouldn't come out and there would be total darkness in this world as there was darkness in my young heart. But the sun came out. It was a beautiful December day. When we passed, you know, we were passing the villages, I remember the children were going to school and they were looking at us so strangely. What are these people surrounded by police? What kind of criminals are being taken away? And I remember some of them waved to us and some of them just made faces.
Who were the people watching you?
Yes.
Who were they?
The children, the farmers. Especially the children. I felt such anguish in my heart and I felt such injustice because I was supposed to be going to school too. And I wasn't a criminal, I didn't do anything wrong. My only crime was that I was a Jewish girl, which I did not consider a crime. And then I thought, what an unjust world that was. I mean, these bullies came, these Germans came with guns, machine guns, and declared war on us Jewish children. I mean, what kind of fight is that? What kind of justice is that? You know, if they had sent us the Hitlerjugend, we would have whipped the pants off them. But they came themselves. What could children do? And I felt very unjust at that point.
So what happened?
Well, they took us, we traveled all morning, and then they brought us to the city of Chortkov and put us in the same prison where my brother Moshe was imprisoned. And they brought us into a hall, asked us to make a circle, and then two SS men went with a bag to collect valuables. You know, I didn't see any valuables. They took everything from us by that time. But some parents still had their wedding rings. So they threw them in. And he came in front of me. They both came in front of me. I had on a pair of earrings my mother gave me when I was maybe 5 years old. I took one earring off and I threw it in the bag. I tried to take the other one off and I couldn't loosen it. So I asked, because, you know, I spoke perfect German, I asked him, may I have some time, please? But one of them just stepped forward and tore the earring off. So I told him, du bist ein Teufel, you are a devil. And then he hit me and threw me on the floor and stepped on me and just stepped over and over again until I lost consciousness. The next thing I remember, waking up in the prison cell, I was bleeding from my mouth and all my body was hurting me because he cracked all my ribs. And there I was in the cell, and then I remember the door opened and they gave us water to drink. They urged us to drink this water, and then I found out later on it was contaminated with typhoid germs. But what I remember, you know, there was a window in my prison cell and there was a bird pecking in the snow. And I said to the bird, you know what, bird, they're going to kill me here. So I'm going to give you my soul, at least my soul will be free. And then I changed my mind and I said to the bird, no, I am going to try to live 1 minute after these murderers pay for their crimes. There was such a need in me to see justice done. And then very soon, I was in that prison cell, and then I heard terrible cries. They were taking people out from the cell and beating them and then bringing them. Some returned, some didn't. But I was already quite ill at the time.
Who were you with?
I beg your pardon?
Who were you with in the cell?
I was with Mrs. Eckerling. Mrs. Eckerling, a lady. I mean, actually, she was her husband and my father were in business together. And then she came, when the German Sockbücher came to my hometown, to Bucic, she died there. And then soon, one day, the door opened and more SS men came in. And then one came close to me. And then all I remember is the boots with those iron spikes coming towards me. And I remember a tremendous amount of pain. And then I just blacked out, just sank. Next thing, I woke up about 2 weeks later.
We're going into the next tape now. Alicia Appleman. You were telling me how suddenly you woke up after 2 weeks.
I woke up after a little bit over 2 weeks. You see, what happened when he beat me, crushed me like that, they threw my body to the cemetery to be buried with all of the other people who were murdered. The people who went to bury us were from the ghetto. They dug the grave and they went to bury us. And when they lifted me up to put me in the grave, I was still alive, because the water that I drank, or maybe I had already germs of typhoid in me, made me sick, and I had a very high fever. So that kept me alive. So they buried me in such a way where when the Germans left, that they took me out of the grave, put me under the straw of their sleigh, and smuggled me into the ghetto. That was in the city of Chortkov.
And who was this?
Mr. Gold. He came with the burial people. And he took me to his home.
Was he Jewish?
Yes. He was a prominent lawyer in the city of Chortkov, yes. He took me to his home, and I was there for 7 weeks, and they taped, I remember waking up, and my body was taped because my ribs were cracked. And it's very difficult to crack children's ribs. And I was very, very ill with typhoid. And at the same time, I also had tuberculosis. But he had gotten help for me, because I remember something bitter being put into my mouth as I was hallucinating, because with typhoid, you have about 11 bad days of very, very high fever. So that's the crisis. If you live through the crisis, you can live. But I was ill on top of it. My body was very badly beaten. I was hemorrhaging internally, and I had tuberculosis. But they did everything for me, Mr. and Mrs. Gold. You know their tragedy. They had an only child, a 16-year-old boy. He was killed a few days before I was taken into their home. He was caught on the street and just shot. So they gave all their energies and all their love to save my life. And they were very brave, because if there had been an action during that time, they couldn't put me in the hiding place, because I would have cried out of the fever and betrayed the place. They would have stayed and died with me. But thank God there wasn't an action then. And then they made it possible for me to return home. They actually returned me home. Can you imagine? After 7 weeks, I came home. But when I came home, what the Germans did, and they did it in other towns, because somebody told me later on, they took people, they contaminated them with typhoid germs, sent them back into the healthy ghetto to get everybody sick there, and then they were claiming that the Jews are spreading typhoid, they all deserve to be killed.
And who told you this?
Who
told you this?
Mr. Gold asked me, because he heard rumors that the people were, this is what they were doing, asked me if I was given water to drink, and I said yes, because I was ill. And when I came home...
Before going back to the cell, how many people were in your cell?
And I think maybe 30. I don't know exactly. But at that time, they took about 60 to 80 people. But they took them apparently for this purpose, to torture and to train the dogs on them and to contaminate them, because they sent about 20 people back from Chortkov, from that prison, to contaminate the rest of the people with typhoid germs.
And how did you know about these 20 people?
I was told when I came back. I didn't know. When I came back and I said, what is this typhoid? They say that people came back sick, and my mother and my little brother were very ill.
Going back to the cell, you said for dogs to be trained?
Yes.
Could you explain that to me?
What happened, they were taking people out of the prison cell, and they were throwing them to the dogs, and the dogs were learning how to take them, to tear them to pieces. Because when they came back into the prison cell, they were mutilated by the dogs. Some of them were still alive.
And you saw this?
I saw it, yes. I saw the people. And Mrs. Eckling also told me what was happening. Yes. I saw it. I saw some of them. And some of them never returned. And the screaming. At night, the screams were terrible.
So now, after 7 weeks, you're back home. Could you describe that day? And how did you get home?
what happened is Mr. Gold arranged for somebody to take me on in his sleigh, because they had to smuggle me out, and it was very wisely done. They put me in like a coffin, and they took all of the dead people on the top and brought them to take them to the cemetery, and I was smuggling out the dead. So when they came to the cemetery, I was already well dead, and I said to myself, God, am I going to be buried in that coffin? But it was just to protect me from all the other dead bodies. And then I came, and he took me. And you know, there was a mystery about this man, because I didn't really know who he was. I have always suspected that he was a Jew masquerading as a Ukrainian. Yes.
And what did Mr. and Mrs. Gold tell you when you left?
Well, they just told me that I should try to live and I should try to survive. And they gave me their son's jacket. And later I found out that the pocket was filled with money, because their son had carried money with him in case he was caught, that he should be able maybe to bribe himself out of the Ukrainian police. They often took bribes, or the German police. But when they caught him, he wasn't wearing his jacket. So they gave me the jacket, and they knew the money was in there. They were wonderful people, but they did not live through it. So when I came home, the first thing that struck me as strange was these signs, typhoid, on the doors. When I came to our house and I opened the door to our room, my heart was beating violently. And then I saw two bodies on the beds. I saw my little brother and my mother. And I came to my mother, and I saw her eyes glazed. I touched them. She had a fever. But then she turned around and looked at me, and then she recognized me. And she says, Alicia, you came home. And I says, yes, Mama, I came home. She knew that I was home. She had typhoid. Both my mother and my little brother had typhoid. And they were just about in the middle of the crisis. And, of course, I did everything possible for them. I tried to get some soup into them and tried to get water, and I sponged them. But I had a very severe problem. You see, there was a hiding place, a very good hiding place in our house that my brother Zachary helped build when we moved into this place. But I could not take my mother and my brother there, because with this high fever, they were hallucinating and screaming. So I had to find some kind of place to hide us in case there was an action. And the only place I knew was to just dig a hole under one of our beds. So I spent nights digging holes, this hole, and I made myself pockets under my skirt and put the earth in, and then I used to go all over the ghetto and just let it loose. Because even if you were building a hiding place in the ghetto, you couldn't just put the soil in the backyard. Because when they came at an action, they saw fresh soil, they knew somebody had dug a hiding place, and they would demolish the house to find the people. So I had to spread it all over wherever I could. And I was digging furiously, because we never knew when an action will start. It always started sometime in the middle of the night, suddenly.
Who was taking care of your mother and your brother while you were gone?
The people in the house, and Bella. Bella, this wonderful Bella. If there was ever a hero, Bella was a hero. Bella came into the ghetto from a small village. Bella was a tall lady with beautiful red hair and green eyes. She had a sister, Rachel, who also had red hair and green eyes. She had two children, Daniel and Hanale. Daniel was about 8 years old at the time, and Hanale was about 2, 3. She was just a little infant. She lived in a village. Her parents were, her father and mother were killed. He was a furrier. And she took her sister and two children, and she made a hole and made a hiding place in the forest. And she used to go around the villages and collect food, because her father had made furs for all of these people, and they gave her food. But then one time the farmers didn't want to give her food anymore, and they followed her into the forest, and they caught her, a sister, and her two children, and put them on a wagon, tied them up.
How did you know all this?
Rachel told me later on the whole story, and tied them up And they were going, and the farmer was going to bring them to the city of Bucharest, to the police, to have them killed. But the farmer wanted to monkey business with her on the way and took her off the wagon. And she carried the whip in her boots. And then she got herself disengaged from this farmer, took out a whip and whipped that farmer really badly and left him there actually naked. And she took the horses and the wagon and drove into the ghetto. And I met them later on in the ghetto. And Rachel told me the whole story, and I thought Bella was a wonderful person. She was very kind to me.
So going back to your own life, your mother and your brother still have typhoid. What happens?
And then they got better. Just when they passed the crisis, one night there was a knock on the window that an action is starting, that the ghetto is surrounded, that they're going to gather us and take us to the graves. And so what I did is I put a blanket into that hole, put my mother in, and then I lifted my little brother into her arms, and I decided that I'm going to lay down on top of this opening. I will take the boards I removed to dig and put them in front of me, hoping that if somebody poked under the bed, maybe they will think they were touching the wall. But even at the age of 12, I realized this is not going to work. And then I got a splendid idea. You know, the Germans always called us names like damn Jews and verfluchten and the stinking Jews and all kinds of ugly names, which didn't bother me because, after all, who are they to call me names? But I thought this would be a very good opportunity to return a compliment, to tell these murdering Germans what I thought of them. You see, we didn't have indoor plumbing. We had an outhouse. And we used a pail there, so I took the pail and I spilled it all over the floor of our bedroom and in the other bedrooms. And I said to myself, okay, when you murderers come, I hope you slip and break your necks.
So this was after you came back?
Yes, that was after I came back. It was very shortly after I came back that this action started.
Could you tell me how many people were living in the house?
16.
What were their names?
The Rosenberg family was there, and they had two daughters, two sons-in-law, and there was the baby Shmulik that died already, and then one was going to have a baby, and there were just some other people. I don't remember their names. But and then I went and lay down under the bed, and very soon the whole house shook. And the door flew open to our room, and from under the bed I could see those boots there. And then they were standing there and cursing, verdammten, verfluchten, verdammten, verfluchten, and one of them says, we'll get them next time, we'll get them next time. But they never entered our room. And then many hours later, maybe 48 hours later, when I looked from the bed and I saw people walking on the streets, I knew the action was over. And so I knocked on the hiding place, on the regular hiding place, and the landlord came out and he sniffled around, he and his daughter. He says, what is this terrible smell in this house, Alicia? So I told him what I did, and he patted me on the head and said, oh, you are a smart girl, Alicia. Now clean it up. And I cleaned it up, but you know, this house never smelled right again. It was a lost cause because it all went into the wood there. But I was very happy I was able to save my mother and my little brother.
And what happened then?
That was 1943. Very soon after I returned, I was home a very short time, when the Germans declared that this city is going to be Judenrein. That means it clean of Jews. The Jewish people cannot live in Bucharest anymore. The ghetto is going to be canceled, and the people can go to one place I know of, to Kopechince, to the ghetto of Kopechince. I imagine there must have been another place, but I wasn't aware of. So my mother, my little brother, and I went to the ghetto of Kopechince. And then,
Before you go to Kopechince, is there any other action that sticks out in your mind that you'd like to tell me about?
Any particular action? Well, we had several actions during that time. One, our first hiding place was in the wall. It was a stone wall that my brother built. And in order to close it, my brother had to stand there and actually hold the stone from the opening. And they were hitting the wall. And they didn't hit that particular place where the opening was. And of course, the thing I would like to share with you is my very great disappointment, of course, that we children couldn't go to school. But what happened is, it was still at the beginning in 1941, when the Christian children went back to school, I gathered my Jewish friends and I decided that I'm going to make a statement. And we all walked into our classroom and sat in our seats. And when the teacher walked in and she saw us there, she got pale to her face and she said, "I'm sorry, you know, because you are not allowed to go to school, you all have to leave the classroom." So I loved my teacher. I didn't want to give her any problems, so we left. But on the way back, I thought there must be some way I could continue learning. I really loved learning. We had a tree growing very close to the window of our classroom. So the following day, around 6 o'clock in the morning, I climbed into that tree, and I sat shivering in the cold leaves until the sun came out. And then at 7:30, the teacher opened the window, and there I was. I saw the blackboard, I saw my teacher, I saw my friends, and I was learning for quite a few weeks. Until one day the teacher put an algebra question on the blackboard. She was looking for a common denominator. And I knew the number, and I forgot totally where I was, and I raised my hand, but I raised the wrong hand, and I came tumbling out of the tree. And of course I screamed, and the teacher came, and she looked at me. She says, "Alicia, you cannot go in the classroom, and you cannot go into the tree." So I told her, "All right," I say, "I will not go into the tree again. But one day if I live through the war, I'm going to go to school forever. And, you know, I go like to school forever." And also about Milek, who came to Buchach. Milek is a great hero, a wonderful boy. I spent my summers in my uncle's home, and from the age of 5, I wanted to be a physician like my uncle. That was my dream, and this is what I was going to be. My uncle had a clinic attached to his home. He was a heart specialist, and this is where his patients were. And this boy, Milek, who was 2 years older than myself, decided at his age of 7 that he is going to be a doctor. So he used to come and visit my uncle, and we became very good friends. And sometimes we used to catch a cat, and we bandaged up the cat, and we were pretending they were our patients. So from the very young age, I fell in love with Milek, and I knew that someday we will both be physicians and serve humanity. When his family was killed, he came to the city of Buchach. And he helped my mother when I was away in the Chotkov prison. He helped my mother. And then when we went to Kopechince, he also went to Kopechince.
So could you now continue telling me how you left to Kopechince?
We left on a wagon to Kopechince. We were of the early people who left. Later on, I heard terrible things and saw people. The people who left after we left were caught at the entrance of the city and taken straight to the graves to be murdered.
And you yourselves?
I was with my mother and my little brother, and Milek came with his friends, and we settled into the Kopechince ghetto. And we were there just settling in a short while when the Germans declared that this ghetto is also going to be canceled out. The city of Kopechince is going to be Judenrein. But they didn't give us a place to go. They didn't say, "Well, from Kopechince you can go to another ghetto. This is where we are going to die." And you know, you might rightfully ask me, "Alicia, how come you didn't escape to forests or to villages, someplace where you could save your lives, right?" It's a good question. But you see, some of us did escape, but we were caught there by the Ukrainians and Poles, and we were literally chopped to pieces. This is the feedback we had from people who, what happened to them, some escaped already. When they went into the forest, they had to come back to the ghetto because they couldn't live in the forest themselves. The danger was there, right there, from the Ukrainians and Poles.
How did the Poles and Ukrainians react to these ghettos?
In Kopechince, I didn't see them in Kopechince. I did not see them in Kopechynice at all. We were just in the ghetto. I did not go out of the ghetto in Kopechynice at all. This was a very strict ghetto, and I wasn't all long enough there. But the only thing I
saw... How old were you then?
I was at that time not even 13. I was 12. I was still 12.
What was your mother like by now?
My mother was, of course, very slender. She started having gray in her hair. And her eyes, her beautiful violet eyes, were so sad. She still smiled for us, for my brother and for me. But she was very, very sad. I could see times that she had cried, her eyes were, but she didn't do it in front of us.
What did she tell you?
She didn't talk about it, but sometimes she used to tell us stories when she was a young girl in Sweden, and how she learned. She was a linguist. She knew all the language. She was a language teacher. She tried to sew some things. She tried to trade for food. She tried to help other children because people were coming in constantly from other places, taken into that ghetto. She was trying to help other people.
What did she tell you about the future?
She, whenever we talked, she said, Alicia, you must try to live, to tell what happened. It was such a need in her. I always sensed that my mother believed that I will be able to tell it. It's interesting because now as an adult, she had such tremendous faith in me. But sometimes she also told me, when she was a little girl, the things that happened to her. She tried to, but she wouldn't let me paint. You see, I was a very accomplished artist. She would never let me paint because when I started painting, it was a lot of red, a lot of blood. That's all I could see in this world. So she was very careful.
So going back to your life, what happened then?
In Kopechynice, yes. Very soon after we settled in, the Germans declared that this is also going to be Judenrein. And then one early morning, we were told that the ghetto is surrounded, that this is going to be the end of us. And I remember I was in the hall, and the man in charge of the building there made the statement. He said, there is a hiding place in this home, but it's very small. So if a mother and father had two children, only one child could go in. And you know, when I heard them say that, I caught his arm and I told him, don't tell my mother. There were two boys who also had sisters. Don't tell our mothers. We will not go in. I give you my word of honor, I won't go in. And I actually kissed his hands. I said, please don't tell my mother. We will not go in. And he looked at me with such sorrow. And he says, okay, I trust you, Alicia. And so I tried to, when people were going into the hiding place that was in the cell, I tried to kind of stay away and hide myself. And my mother found me. She was so angry at me. This is the first time in my life that my mother would have hit me. And she says to me, you should know better than procrastinate. You know that minutes make a difference between life and death. She didn't hear this man say about the fact that two children couldn't go in. And so she dragged me down. We were the last of the people to come in. And then there was an opening, a wooden frame, and people, it was a tunnel under it, and people were catching each other. So I told my mother that she should go in and she will catch me. And I will take the wooden box and close the hiding place. I will try to put stuff on it and close it. My mother was holding up arms, and I told her if she lowered her arms, it will be easy for me to go in. The minute she lowered her arms, I took the wooden box and closed the opening. And I heard a scream that pierced me in my heart. And then I took all kinds of junk that was in that cellar there, and I put it on top of that area, hoping that, you know, if I disguise it, nobody's going to think that people are hiding under this junk. And I went looking for the boys, hoping that maybe we could find a hiding place together or something. But I didn't find them. And I decided the only place I could go at this point, maybe I will go to the attic. And maybe I will find a place. What I really wanted to is to disappear into thin air. As I was climbing on the ladder, suddenly I heard a baby cry. See, there were two babies in our house, and we found out through our experience that babies could not be taken into hiding places because they would cry and the Germans would hear the babies and they would find the hiding places. So very often the babies were given a strong tea drugged and hidden. the mother would be knocked out by the father and taken into the hiding place, and the babies would have to hope that they will survive. Now, in this case, I had to make up my mind, am I going to climb to the attic, or am I going to try to save the baby? And I decided to save the baby. So I returned and I went into the room. There were two babies. I loved these babies. I made friends with them. And there was this little ball with the tea. The tea was in a little sack. And I took the ball and I was dropping it in the baby's mouth. One of the babies was sleeping. And I was urging him, hurry up, fall asleep so I can save you. And the baby was closing the eyes. And it would have been just a matter of 1 minute. But suddenly the whole house shook. The door flew open to our room. Two SS men entered, and with all this terrible noise, both babies woke up and started to cry. And one of the Germans, one of the SS men, went over where the babies were, pulled out his gun, and shot the babies through the mouth.
In front of you?
In front of me, just like that. And I said something, and one of them hit me. And I don't know why they didn't kill me. But they gave a command out, and then they took me to the prison yard. And then people started coming, taking all over the ghetto. And then I found people from the Buchach ghetto.
After that incident, what were you like?
I was in shock. I was angry. I hated them. There was such a burning sensation in my heart. I said to myself, there must be some way that they have paid for their crimes. There was such anger and such hatred in my heart for them. How could they do something like that?
Could you describe the two German officers who did that?
What they looked like? They had green uniforms on. They had the swastika on. They had the SS emblem. To me, they looked like devils. You know, they portray them in the movies and in the television, tall, blonde, with those blue eyes, these in leather coats. To me, they were ugly rats, murdering cowards. That's what they were.
What were their faces like when they
ugly.
Did this?
Pure ugly.
And after they did that, what did they look like?
Ugly.
What
tall,
did they say?
Ugly. They didn't say anything to me.
What did they say to each other after they killed the babies?
They didn't say anything. They didn't say. They pushed me out, and then I joined the other people that were taken out. Just ugly murderers. Cowards.
So what did you do next?
I was taken to a prison, and they put us in the prison. Yeah, they gathered us there, and then the following morning, they took us out to the graves, but I want to tell you what happened. I sat near a mother who had two children. And a little baby boy, maybe 18 months or something like that, she was just holding her. And a little girl, five, she told me she was five. I sat near her, a beautiful little girl. And the little girl turned to her mother and she says, Mamushu, jeme ijeme. Mommy, where are we going? And the mother says, ijeme to tatusha, we are going to daddy. And the little girl jumped up and she was saying, we are going to daddy, we are going to daddy. The following morning when they pushed us out, the mother was holding the baby and she was walking the front and I was holding the little girl's hand. In the other hand she was holding her doll. Somebody was shot in back of us and we were pushed forward. The little girl dropped the doll. And one of the assessment came up, picked up the doll, handed it to the little girl. She smiled at him, and then he took out his gun and shot her face away. And I picked in front of me, and I picked the little girl and I carried her in my arms. I couldn't just leave her there, and I carried her to the grave.
And her mother?
Her mother never knew what happened.
Where was she?
She was in front of us. Because, you know, when you walk, a lot of people pushing you. And then I brought her to the grave with me. I want you to know something very important, extremely important. Because we are...
In the next tape. We're going to the next tape now. Thank you. You were telling me you wanted to say something very important.
Kathy, I want to share two things with you, which are very important. There weren't too many people who escaped from graves. You must be wondering, how come all these thousands of people were piled around through? We were surrounded there, that we didn't run, that we didn't do something. Now, remember, among us, maybe half and maybe less, were children, were infants. If people started running, these children would suffer a terrible death. Now, this is why we did not run, and this is why we remained very quiet. I want to tell you, in front of me was standing a father with a boy, about 10 years old, and the boy turned to the father and he asked him in Yiddish, "Father, will it hurt?" And the father said, "No, child." And when they shot them, the father was still embracing his son, and the son fell into the grave alive.
You saw this?
Yes. I heard him, and I understood the Yiddish, because he asked if it weighed tuned. And I didn't know too much Yiddish, but I understood that. And the second thing I want to tell you, which is extremely important.
What happened to you then?
What happened? But I just want to bring out another point. At this grave in Kopetrince, in the beginning of the summer of 1943, when the ghetto was being canceled, I want to bear witness to this, that at the grave were not only the SS men, but there were the Wehrmacht, ordinary soldiers, and the Luftwaffe pilots were there killing us. Because in history, they believed that it was just, and Nazis, they called them Nazis. And not only were they killing us, but they were throwing the babies and they were shooting, and they were hilarious.
You saw this?
I saw it with my own
eyes. Could you describe? You were in the grave?
I was at the edge of the grave.
Could you describe what happened?
What happened is, it was my turn to be killed when suddenly I heard a scream, "Alicia Appleman, run! Alicia Appleman, run!" You know, for me it was like I was already dead and somebody was calling me from someplace. And I turned around and I heard, "Alicia, Alicia." It was Milek, my friend Milek. He was caught. And he was standing not far from me and he was also going to be killed. And suddenly I heard the commotion with his screaming. He jumped up to a German and pulled his machine gun and started shooting at the Germans. And then there was a whole set up. I mean, it was like a nightmare, starting all over inside the nightmare. And people started running into the forest because the grave was dark, just about where the forest was beginning. And I ran. And other people were running. And I didn't know at all what happened. I heard machine gun, I heard shooting, I heard screaming. And I ran into the forest and I kept falling and picking myself up and crying because I was sure that Milek died there. You see, Milek didn't. He also escaped.
Could you tell me what continued? So you.
I don't know what happened at the grave because I was already in the forest.
So what did you do in the forest?
First of all, I needed clothes, and I tried to get some clothes, and I was just running and hiding in the forest, and then I got some clothes, which I had to take from. Grass where it was drying, and I decided that I will go to Buchach, that I will not return to the Kopetrince ghetto. Before we left Buchach, my mother, my little brother, and I, my mother told us, if we are ever separated, that we should not go back to the place where we came from, but return to Buchach. We will meet in Buchach because we know the area, we know the villages, we know the forest, that somehow along the line we should go back there and not back to Kopetrince or not back to wherever we will be. So I was going to Buchach and I was on the way as I was going. I was working in the fields. I went out and begged for work and this is how I got a little bit of bread and some potatoes and some of this sour milk, what they call it, it's like buttermilk. And I came back to Buchach. But I didn't know what happened to Milek. I was sure that Milek died there.
Before you tell me any more, you said that on the way you worked at farms?
Yeah, and fields.
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 What kind of work did you do?
Like weeding the weeds out of potatoes and all the other things that were growing in the ground.
Did no one think you were Jewish?
Yes, well, there was a girl who thought she was quite nasty to me in one of the fields. I pretended to be a refugee going into the other direction, not going to Butch, going from Butch. Because if I was going for Kombatchinze, they could suspect because they knew what was happening, you know, they probably heard the shooting. And so I pretended that I was going to join my family. And sometimes they believed me, sometimes they didn't. But one of the girls didn't believe me, but she gave me some potatoes anyway. And I spoke the Ukrainian language perfectly. I spoke Polish perfectly. And when I was on the field, the fields there, I used to look mostly on fields where women worked. And I thought, well, the women are not going to leave their fields and going to kill me or going to bring me to the police. So I would be fairly safe with them. But I never stayed more than a few hours, and then I went back into the forest. And I stayed the night in the forest, and I continued with this little bit of bread. It took me quite a few days to get back to Butchach.
Did you have to change your behavior while you were with them?
I didn't talk much. I just worked.
So what happened when you got back to Butchach?
When I got back to Butchach, the first thing I did, I knew a family, Pisarski. I went to them and I asked for some food. And I told them that, because my mother knew them too, they lived not far from the ghetto. And I told them, in case my mother or my brother shows up, to tell them that I am in this area. And then I left because they were so afraid for me to be seen there. First of all, they didn't believe that I was still alive. They thought that I was some kind of myth or some shadow or something like that. But I left because I didn't want to endanger them either. But my mother found out. She came back and she went to them. And she found out that I am in this area. And then she was searching for me. Can you imagine searching for somebody in the fields or in the forest or in the villages? This is almost impossible. And I went into the village there, and I found in the fields a little house, a little shack. The farmers used it, didn't have any windows. It was a thatched roof built out of wood. And inside, the farmers who worked the field kept their tools. And when it rains, they stayed over there. Or when they had lunch, they could go or store things. Nobody ever. And I found it. And I made a hole, put straw on the top, and I lived there. In this place, and I had some of the food that the Pisarskis gave me, and I lived on it. And then every very early in the morning, I left, and I hid in a ravine or anywhere in the fields so that nobody should find me in this place. But I was very tired, and I overslept. And suddenly, one morning, I felt like something fell upon me, and there was a boy on top of me. He went into the shack. I didn't hear them because I was fast asleep. And he stepped on this hole because it just was straw covering it. And he fell into me. Anyway, what happened is this boy and his cousin, the cousin was Lala, was a girlfriend of mine. And of course she recognized me. But what happened is when I came back to Butchach, Milek had given me a ring. And I hid this ring in the wall. And I took this ring out, and I was wearing this gold ring. And he wanted that ring, and I didn't want to give it to him. And finally, I gave it to him. Because I thought, if I don't give it to him, he's going to let everybody know that the Jewish girl is hiding there. But I think later on, when I wrote my book, I realized that I gave it this ring to him because I didn't want Lala to suffer, my friend, to be angry at him. And not, because I could have taken him on, we could have fought, and I would have gotten that ring. Well, didn't have to give him up the ring, but I didn't want it to be sad. But when they left, after he took the ring from me, they left. And on the way, they were talking. Because that night, I had a dream about my mother, somebody waking up, and it was really my mother. See, my mother was hidden under bushes not far from that same field, and she heard the two children talk. And she recognized Lala, because Lala was my friend, and she realized that they were talking about me. And this is how my mother found me.
Could you describe how you
got there? I thought that she was a ghost. I was really frightened. And I found my mother. And then I was together with my mother.
What did she tell you?
She told me that they canceled out the ghetto, that she and Herzl were going to go to Buchach. But Herzl wanted to go out and see what was happening. And they got separated. But that she believed that Herzl knew, because she talked to him before, that he will go to Buchach. Now, Herzl came to Buchach. Later on, I found out. He came to Buchach. He was looking for us. But he was on the street. He was just 10 years old. And remember I told you about my friend Slavka? Now, she had a brother, Bohdan. They had a cousin who was a Ukrainian policeman. Now, Bohdan was Herzl's friend. And what happened, apparently...
Who told you this?
This is what I surmised from what happened to my brother, because later on I heard that my brother was killed. And after the liberation, when I was with Slavka, Bohdan was, I heard that he was killed. He was recognized by a friend, but I didn't know who was the friend. And it turned out to be it was Slavka's brother, who was working with his Ukrainian cousin, and they caught him, and the Ukrainian policeman killed him.
When did you find out that your brother had been killed?
I found out when I sent Vujicu later on, when I sent somebody to...
So going back to your mother is now found you.
Okay.
I
found, one day I came upon a little shack, a little house, a little shack, and there was a man... Somebody was laying there in front of this house, and I thought it was a dead person. It was an old man, which later I found out had epileptic seizures. He was a Polish man, very nice man. We befriended him, my mother and I befriended him, and he let us stay in his place. Now, I went to work every morning into the fields. I walked 2 and 3 and 4 miles away from that village of Wojciechówka. So, and I went to the fields, I saw people working, I offered to work there. And then they gave me something for lunch, and then whatever, they had a piece of bread left over, of potatoes, I took them to my mother. And then another woman came with her 2 daughters. And then one day I was working in the field, and we were harvesting potatoes, and that was 1943. And I overheard somebody, 2 Ukrainian young boys were working there. They said they were laughing because they found this Jews in the fields, and that they are going to kill them. Actually, we weren't harvesting potatoes. We were weeding potatoes. We were taking the weeds out. So it was like in middle of the summer, before harvest.
1943.
And they say that they were in that wheat field, and that they are going to, the Ukrainian police know about them, that they are going to kill them. And they were laughing and things like that. I say, well, and they would say the wheat field near the mill there. And so, you know, there are many wheat fields. And then I realized they are going to be killed. So the only way I can do is try to find them before they are found and try to rescue them and take them to safety. Can you imagine my trying to find that field? But when people were hiding, the wheat in Poland is very tall. And when you go into the field, you make tracks because you have to separate the stalks. And they stay separated because people don't really know how to walk in the field. And so finally I found that area that was damaged, the stalk, and I tracked them down. That was a mother with 2 children, a boy and a girl. I had strange feelings when I saw them because I was angry at them that they have left such tracks, that they were tracked down. I was angry at them because we are all going to die very soon because I didn't know when they will come to pick them up. But I had tremendous compassion for them. And then I was mad at the Germans, why they should, you know, try to take them. And then I was mad at the Ukrainians that they have told the Germans. It was a whole anger and hatred towards the whole situation. But I got them away from there. And I brought them, and it was daylight, mind you. I had no choice. I hid them, and then in the evening, I brought them to Weech's house. And I felt very badly about it because I was kind of throwing these people without his permission. Felt very badly. You see, Kathy, with all that was happening, we children retained our sense of dignity. We knew we couldn't do things like that, impose on somebody. We had to have permission, and I knew that I didn't have permission from Witcher to bring these people. I brought them anyway.
How did he react?
Oh, he didn't like it at all. He was, you know, very indignant, but I let my mother handle him. And I was a coward, and I just left for a couple of days because I was just really afraid that he's going to be angry, very angry with me. But he accepted him.
What was your mother like now, after now she has lost all her family except you?
My mother's hair got quite gray. Her eyes were extremely sad, extremely sad. But she lived for me. I don't know where she got the strength to live for me. And it was something that, as an adult, as a mother myself, I can understand. Her heart was broken, but she had a tremendous amount of love for me. She knew if she gives up, then I may not be able to survive.
This old man who was hiding you, what was his complete name?
Wichu. He had a Polish name, too, but I didn't know it at the time. He was actually, later I found out, from one of the girls that was hidden with us, that he was a Polish nobleman. He was married to a concert pianist in Paris, and when she died a sudden death, he got ill and he hid in this land, in this little shack that actually belonged to another nobleman, a Polish nobleman. He resigned from the world. He didn't have any hair. He didn't have any teeth. He looked like a son with those beautiful blue eyes. He was a splendid, beautiful man. Of course, we had lice, you know. And whenever I offered to delouse a shirt, he said, Alicia, he called me in Polish, Alicia, are you going to bring more Jews? I say, Wojciech, you know, if I found them, I would bring them. He says, yes, I know.
Were you ever suspected of being in hiding there?
You know what was, they didn't know. I thought they didn't know, but they did find us, and I will tell you about it. It was the winter of 1943. I had met a very fine Polish girl, Mania, and she had given me a blouse, because I had only one blouse and one skirt made out of a blanket. And when we had to bathe, we went into this little brook, my mother and we went into it, we took our clothes off, washed them, and put them on. It was bitter cold, it rang them out. We couldn't dry it. We put them on and they had to dry on our bodies. By the way, while I met him, I want to tell you about something that happened. One Sunday we were late to go and bathe. To just think about what a beautiful
human being. How long after you found your mother?
I found my mother in the summer of 1943, and now it was the fall of 1943. And so we woke up late and we went to this brook to bathe anyway. And as I took off my clothes and I rinsed them out because we didn't have any soap, put them on, and I had to put a rope around me to hold up that skirt because I was a skeleton. You could see all my cracked ribs. And I looked into the water and I reflected my face and all I saw was big eyes. And the rest of us just really like a skeleton. And I looked at my mother and I asked her, Mommy, will I ever be a lady? And she said to me, Alicia, you are already a lady. And then she told me the definition, Plato's definition of a lady is a person who is considerate of others. It's nothing to do with jewelry or beautiful clothes. And then I put my little shirt on and I said to myself, my mother said I was a lady. And there were times when I thought I would perish, but I held my head high because my mother said I was a lady and I had to behave accordingly.
Could you describe how your life went on?
Yes, it was winter, and this girl had given me this blouse, and I came to Witches. We heated some snow, and I had just washed my hair and put on the blouse. It was maybe 9 o'clock at night, winter. It was Christmas Eve, when suddenly we heard a knocking on the door, and the Ukrainian voice says, "Open, you damn Jews, I know you are there, open the door." Can you imagine how we felt? Our hearts stopped beating. I knew one thing, that I will protect my mother with my life. I am not going to see my mother killed. Anyway, there was a little kitchen where we lived in, and then there was a little room near the door, and there was another room where Witcher kept some of the straw. So all of the people went into this room, and they covered themselves with straw. I thought for a moment maybe I should do the same thing, but I decided this is not going to work. Close the door, and I opened the door, and they all flew in, you know, because suddenly I opened the door. And then they say, "Where is everybody?" And one of the boys stepped forward and looked at me. I've worked in his parents' fields for a few days, harvested. And I knew him. His name was Pietro. I knew him very well because we were working and harvesting together. I wasn't near him, but I was at one end. And what happened during the time, he had a very beautiful voice. And he was singing from a play called Natalka Poltavka. It's about a village girl whose sweetheart went away, and she was singing her heart out to him, and then he was answering her. I was in the same play during the Russian occupation.
So what happened?
I was Natalka. So when he was singing the boys' role, I was answering him as Natalka. We were singing to each other.
So what happened when
we never took? So when he says, "Slavka, what are you doing among the Jews?" See, he didn't know I was Jewish. So I told him, I'm a Jew. And he, you know, was shocked. And then they started clamoring to get away. So I made my speech. And I told him, I say, "We are just women and children here, innocent people." And I made my first speech. I say, "For the crime that you are going to commit here, I say to them, I swear on your God and my God, I will hunt you to the grave. If you ever have children, you will see my eyes in them and the crime that you will be committing. You will never be forgiven it. It will live with you, and our innocent blood will be on you." And I kept talking and talking, and our eyes connected. And suddenly it was very quiet, and he motioned them out. And they left us. And of course, we couldn't stay there anymore. And so I knew some farmers who had barns, and I knew which would be okay. So I told the people where to go. I led them there. And when my mother and some of the people went into that barn, we were in two barns, I was afraid to go into the barn because I was afraid they would come after us. You know, I was already so frightened. So there was a doghouse there, and I crawled into that doghouse, and I stayed in the doghouse looking out, hoping if something will happen so I can go and protect them again. But the farmer came out and he wanted his dog to go into the doghouse, and the dog was barking because he couldn't go into the doghouse because I was in the doghouse. The poor dog had such a very bad time, he couldn't go in there. So I felt badly for the dog. Anyway, that's the time when I stopped sleeping nights because I was constantly watching and being afraid that they may come back. Now that was...
So where would you be sleeping?
I would not be. We had to go back to Vujicic. We had absolutely nowhere to be. We were just waiting there. We had nowhere to go because we couldn't be in the barns. They found that they would kill us there.
So you went back?
We went back to
Vujicic. And what did you do when you got back?
When we went back, I went during the day. I was trying to beg for some food or some work. But at night, I knew they would come. They come at night. I was on watch, and I thought, hopefully, that I will be awake and I will be able to stop them from killing us the second time. But they never came back. What happened then, it went into January, and word went around that the Germans are being defeated in that Eastern Front and that the Russians were coming. And then one time in February, a contingency of Russian partisans passed that village, and the villagers thought that that was the Russians coming, but they were just partisans. But it, it made them afraid to look for Jews or kill, because they shouldn't pay later on. Not that anybody paid for killing Jews, but that they assumed that somebody is going to punish them for their murders.
How did your life continue?
And my life continued until March, and then we were liberated in March. The Russians came into that area.
Before you tell me about your liberation, were you very hungry during all this time?
Very hungry.
Could you describe?
I used to eat grass, and I ate flowers. Were there any flowers blooming? I ate flowers. My stomach must have shrunk to very little. Some people, when I went, I always asked for work first before I begged. I used to milk cows. I used to clean the stables. I used to I did everything possible.
And your mother?
My mother stayed in one place. You see, my mother, I could never let her go out in the village. My mother was very, very beautiful. She had this black hair, white skin, and violet eyes. Nobody in the village looked like my mother. It was very obvious that this was not a Polish, a Ukrainian woman. She was just too beautiful. Not that, please don't get me wrong, not that Ukrainian and Polish women were not beautiful. She was just not a village woman.
So you fed your mother?
I beg your pardon? I hid my mother. I never let her go out.
And how did you get food?
I brought it to her. You see, I went back, when I worked in the fields, I went back to sleep in Vujicic. So I brought potatoes and I brought bread or whatever milk they gave me. And if they were kind people, they told me, okay. I asked them, I said, can I come and work in your house? And they said, because they thought when I was working with them that I was a Ukrainian or Polish girl, but they knew eventually that I was a Jewish girl.
What is it like to be hungry?
Well, I will give you an example. We had this a stove in Poland, in this little shack. It was made out of stones, and there was a plate, an iron plate, and an opening. You put in wood or whatever you had in there, and the plate heated up, and then you took a potato and you sliced very thin pieces. You put them and baked them, and then you were so hungry that when your turn came to pick up that little piece of potato, you burned your fingers. You burned your tongue because you were so hungry. You couldn't wait for it to cool off. And then when I lay down, I put my fists in my stomach so that my intestines, when they fell over and they hurt me, they should be stopped. I was very, very hungry. And when I was given a piece of bread, I never even took a crumb. I brought it to my mother. My mother divided it up. And we used to get some things, so we cooked this soup.
And then you said you were liberated?
Then we were liberated, but again, that was in March of 1944. But I was still not sure what was happening, so my mother and I decided that I will go in first to Buchach and find out if things are okay, and then she will come. And I went in, and I met my friend Slauka, and she brought me to her home, and I was going to sleep with her in her bedroom, but I couldn't sleep on a bed. I wasn't used to sleeping on a bed anymore. I turned and tossed and turned and tossed.
Could you describe the day that you were liberated?
What happened is, I went to beg for food, and the people told me that the Russians are here. See, I didn't know it, and then I went to look on the street and there on the road, and there they were traveling. The Russians were traveling. What did I can tell you, I was very happy, but remember, there was something very important about us. That was not a rejoicing, time of rejoicing. That was a time of facing the truth, because when we were trying to survive, when we were fighting to survive, we were aware of what happened, but we didn't let it into our minds to extend where it will drive us crazy. But when the liberation came, when we were finally free, the tragedy hit us with full power. Now, I was 13, not even 14 years old when I was liberated, because my birthday was in May, and that was March.
We're going now into the next tape. Thank you. You were telling me that you were liberated and you got back to Buchach.
My mother came and we stayed with Slavka, and then she found an apartment for us. And then my mother became the person who sold to our food, and I became the child again. And then I met some people. When I was still in the fields, I met a group of Jewish partisans who actually had guns. It's the same group that my brother organized. There were other partisans in the forest, and they were liberated. So when we were liberated, there were several hundred people, not necessarily from my hometown, but from this whole area, because about 40,000 people died in my hometown. About maybe 300 or 400 people could have survived. I don't know how many.
Were they all Jewish?
Yes, the ones who survived, and many of them were young people from part that who hid in the forest, had hiding places in the forest, who were partisans, who were taking their revenge during the occupation. Later, these boys could fight back because there was not a question of retaliation anymore. I want you to know, Kathy, something very important. When people ask, why didn't the Jews fight back? And there was this terrible, tragic thing. If you killed one German, they took hundreds and hundreds of people from the ghetto, men, women, and children, and they massacred them.
Did you see this?
I beg your pardon. In our hometown, I didn't see it, but later on I heard about instances where the Germans were killed. Even a village I heard in Czechoslovakia.
So first, before you can tell me that later, going back to your life.
We came back, and these people who were liberated, we were walking around like shadows, just seeing each other. We hardly talked to each other. We just like mimicked. Nobody was left. And then one day I was standing in the corner near the drugstore, and I saw a young girl wearing a fur jacket. My friend, my Jewish friend, had gotten for her birthday from her father, and just about broke my heart. And I used to go and visit sometimes the police, the prison, and I was happy to see, you know, people who are not, you know, really in prison anymore. And my mother, I saw Milek one time. That's when I found that he survived, but he stayed a very short time. He went back to Stanislava, where he came from, to look for his family. And we were liberated a short time, I think April, about 2 months we were liberated. And we thought, well, this is what it's going to be like. When one night we heard cannon shots and shooting, and we went outside on the street and we saw people running, what happened is the Germans were coming back. I found out later on that the Russians were in such a hurry to go west, they surrounded three German divisions in the city of Tarnopol. The Germans broke out, and they came back. The Russians didn't even tell us that the Germans were coming back. Nothing. We found out that particular night. And so my mother and I were running to go to with the Russians, to go away from the Germans. And my mother was hit by a piece of shrapnel in her thigh, was very badly wounded. So we couldn't run anymore. We finally got back to our home, and then the second nightmare started all over again. My mother was very ill because she was one that didn't have medicine for her. I did see an ambulance, and I would have gone in and maybe stolen some medicine for her. But then I thought, if I'm caught, what is going to happen to my mother? Now, the person in charge of this building where people lived was a Polish woman. And a few days later, after the Germans came in, she went to the police. And one day, two SS men came in into our apartment, and they motioned us to go out in the yard. And I helped my mother, was holding up my mother. And one of them pulled out a gun and shot at me. And my mother threw herself in front of me. And she was killed. And then he shot again, and he didn't have a bullet. There was no bullet in his gun. I don't know why the second one didn't kill me. But they took me to the prison, and then I found other people.
Before you tell me that.
Her what? Last words to me. You must live, Alicia.
What? At that moment.
I had fury in my heart. But I think I was also in shock. You can't help it to see something like that in front of your eyes. I just stood there. You know, I didn't run, I didn't do anything, just holding up my mother.
Where was your mother shot?
She was shot through the heart.
And what happened with her?
I don't know. When he hit me and he motioned me to go out, to follow in the front.
Did you say anything? Did you touch her?
Yes, I kissed her.
Could you describe what happened?
It's almost indescribable. And I was taken to prison, and then other people were there because they were betrayed. They didn't have a chance to hide, and the good neighbors brought the police and they betrayed them. And among them was a young girl, was my brother Zachary's friend. And I knew this was the prison when I was there already before, when they took me to Chortkov, that the place they will probably take us is to the feather, to this forest, and that's where they will kill us. Their favorite burial place for us killing was near the football place where they played soccer. That area, the route to the forest, there was a sloping hill and it was planted with pine trees. I knew that area because during the ghetto times I used to go through the river into the forest and pick up the branches. The Poles used to cut down the trees, steal the wood, and they left the branches, and we kids used to flow them through. And once the Polish kids ambushed us and took the branches away from us, and I was able to hide myself in a hollow tree that was hollowed out from the side of the river. It was growing between the river and in the foot of the hill. From the river, the water hollowed it out.
So what happened this time?
Okay, so I told Eva, I told this girl, I said, look, if they're going to kill us, I know if they're killing us in that area, I know how to escape and I know where to hide. Now, just make sure, follow me, we will hold hands and follow me. But I have to rest. I have to close my eyes because I knew the only way I can survive and face anything after having seen my mother cruelly murdered in front of my eyes, that if I close my eyes and I sleep, maybe I will be able to wake up and function. When I woke up and I told Eva about this, she had, during that time when I was sleeping, spaced herself out of life. I couldn't reach her at all. And so when we walk, I kept telling her, now remember what is going to happen. We are going to run when we get there. And this is what you are going to do. And you will follow me. If we are separated, you follow me. Run after me. I know where to hide. And I told her about the street and everything. But when we came to the grave, she was pulling me towards the grave. I was pulling her away. She was pulling me. She was completely, her mind had blanked out. totally. She'd separated herself from the pain and from the process of dying, of everything. And this happened to quite a few people, I found out later on. Now, she was about 18 at the time, and I was 13. I was already 14. I had my birthday. So there was a difference of us viewing things. And so I pulled her, and then finally we got separated. And I said, this is, she's never going to follow me. She was just going with everybody. And I sprinted, and I did get into that tree, and I hit there. And other people were running too. People were escaping. And then I heard dogs, and I heard shouting. But I hit in that hollow tree through the day, and I was very, very cold. And then I swam over, and I continued going there. And that is when the second occupation started, and the front was not far from there, and I was hiding with all of these refugees. And then I came to a clearing. People had to escape from the front area, and they became refugees. They were Ukrainians and Poles. And we were all sitting in that clearing. There was an older man there. He had some flour. And he was
near what city was this?
Buchach. And he was making these little pancakes, and he even gave me one. I don't know if he knew I was a Jewish girl or not, but there were children there, so I was sitting with them together. The following morning, I took a little walk and wanted to see about the forest, wanted to find out maybe I will have to hide in the forest to escape. But as I was coming near the forest, I saw a silhouette. I saw somebody standing there to go to the story, to the eye of the story. I found it was a Jewish boy who was hiding in the forest, and I was talking to him. And as I was talking to him, I turned around and I saw a mounted soldier on a horse who came into this area, and the old man came up to him and was pointing in my direction and was saying something to him. I didn't hear what he was saying, but I immediately got suspicious, because why should he send this mounted soldier in my direction? So I thought maybe this is exactly what he did. He says he was a soldier, an officer, a cavalry officer. And he came up where the area was, and I told the boy to run into the forest. I would have run too, but he saw me there. And if I ran into the forest, and if he was an SS man, he would have gone in the forest and most likely found both of us. So I had to make a decision. One of us has to escape, and the boy was the likely candidate.
So what happened?
Okay, so he came up, and he asked me to sit on the ground, and he was mounted on the horse. And as I sat down on the ground, I kind of pulled my leg out close to his horse, because I was a very good rider. And I said to myself, if he's going to shoot me, I'm going to try to hit his horse, and maybe I will dismount him or something. And then he looked down on me, and we looked at each other, and he says, "Du bist ja unschuldig, Mädchen, you innocent girl." And he rode away. He was just a lost soldier himself. He just didn't want to shoot me.
So what happened after that?
After that, I was very angry and very hurt, because here was this man. I mean, there was this soldier, if it was at least an SS man. But he was this soldier. He wasn't looking for Jews. He was lost. He was lost. He came into that clearing. And so I had a few things. I went and I picked them up, and I just walked away. And I walked around in that forest and around. Then the shock of my mother's death set in. And being betrayed like that and worrying, looking for this boy and not finding him, because I didn't know what happened to him. And I was just going in circles and circles. And then one night I had a dream, and my mother was talking to me. She said, "Get up, Alicia, get going, get going." And finally I got out of that forest, and I followed. Instead of going towards Buchach, I was away, was going away from Buchach. And I thought, I'm going to go to Western Poland. I will just go and go and go west. And maybe wherever I will end up, maybe I will be able to pretend I was a refugee or a Polish girl or Ukraine girl.
So where did you go?
And then I was working in the fields again. And then how I met then I came to the city of Przemyśl on the outskirts, where the train station, and I saw a train, and I saw boys and girls, and the girls were dressed up in festive Ukrainian clothes, and there was a pump there, and I wanted to drink some water, and there was a girl drinking. Then I asked the Ukrainian where she was going, and they said that they are going to work on German farms. They were taken to Germany. And she was so friendly, and I was so lonely. And when she was going to the train, I followed her. And when they pulled her into the train, I pulled out my hands, they pulled me, and I was sitting there with these boys and girls going to these farms. They didn't really know who I was, because I spoke a perfect Ukrainian. And the train just started moving. They closed the door, started moving. Then suddenly we heard explosions. You see, this train had several cars with boys and girls going to Germany to work, but some of the passenger cars were filled with SS, Gestapo. The partisans, the Kolpak partisans, found out and they blew up those cars, and there was a massacre there. And then somebody opened the door, and we ran out into the ditch. And while I was running, I got a piece of shrapnel in two places, in one in my leg, in here, in my tush. I still have the piece there inside me. And we were in that ditch. And then they gathered up all the boys and girls and put us in downstairs in the basement, in the basement room in the prison. And they were going to check the documents because they believed that it was somebody from this train that told the partisans that there are Germans in the car, all kind of story. And then I thought I was in terrible trouble because, you see, I didn't have any documents to identify who I was, and who doesn't have documents. And the way I was dressed, I wasn't really looking like a girl going to Germany. And so I told them a story that I ran away from my cruel stepmother and that I left my little brother and that I should get out of here. So there was a little window which was very difficult to open, and they opened that window the window opened inside. Can you imagine what kind of terrible thing it is? Anyway, they heaved me up and I crawled out of this window, and I was already wounded, you know. And as I was crawling, I looked in another window, and I saw there people wearing khaki with bandages all over them, and I realized immediately that these must be some partisans, some people who have, you know, we knew already the story, that were called wounded. And I knocked on that window, knocked on that window, knocked on that window. And I was frightened because any time they could catch me. And finally somebody came to that window, had the bandaged head, and I motioned them that I will pull them out. Well, they prayed that window. And I pulled eight partisans out of this window.
What nationality?
Russian partisans. And then I asked them to go with them, because I knew already from the first time that there were partisans in this area.
Did you know their names?
No, I didn't know their names. And so I asked them to take me along. They said they can't take a wounded girl along. And they disappeared into the forest. And then I started walking. I went through this forest, and then I tried to find some place where I could be a shepherdess or work in the fields. And then finally I found a home where they took me in as a shepherdess. I worked day and night, worked in the fields and worked as a shepherd. And that was not far from the front, from the Russian-German front. And I was in that village, and the girl who, the daughter of the house, wasn't very happy for me to be there, and I was nearly starving if it wasn't for two little twin brothers. They were very kind to me.
What was the name of the family?
I don't remember.
And what date was this?
That was the fall of 1944. It was September 1944, October 1944. You could hear shooting. It was not far from the Hungarian border. It was in Turkana Stream, in a small village there. And then the Germans came and wanted the girls, the village girls, to come and peel potatoes for their field kitchen. And the farmer was terribly afraid of his beautiful daughter to go and work in this field kitchen, peel potatoes. And they kind of volunteered me, and I said, well, he is giving me a place to be, and I will go instead of the girl, because after all, I got fine, skinny again. I had gained some weight, and I lost some weight, and my clothes wasn't exactly what you would call.
So you went with German soldiers?
So I went to that kitchen with other girls.
They never suspected you of being Jewish?
No, they didn't suspect me. They didn't care. They didn't pay any attention. They were combat soldiers. And I was peeling potatoes because I had another reason. If I could get the peels And I could make a little fire and I could, you know, bake the peels and I have some extra food. And we were peeling there. And then and the farmers were so, the father and mother of this girl were so afraid that the Germans will do something to this girl. And so they were very happy if I volunteered in her place. And I wanted these potato peels, so I had my alternative mode.
So you went?
So I went, and I was sitting there with other girls and peeling the potatoes. And then after they cooked the soup, they had this big cauldron. And they said, well, now you have to wash it. And none of the girls wanted to go inside and wash it. And they volunteered me. And they said, you go. So I went in, and I sat in there, and on the brim of this thing were wonderful vegetables. They were all caught there, you know. And there I was sitting, instead of cleaning this thing, I was eating my fill. The following day, nobody had to volunteer. I was very happy to get into this cauldron and get myself all these wonderful vegetables. The cauldron was empty, but the vegetables were stuck around it.
And how long did you stay there?
Well, I was working there for about 3 days. Then one afternoon after, when I was going to wash this thing out, there were some soldiers who picked up their soups and were sitting and eating, and they picked them up in these jars. I heard them speaking, and one of them said, in German, I understand, they say that finally they found all of these partisans and they are going to be surrounded, and they finally get rid of these damned partisans. And they were going on the partisans, and they have to hurry up because they are going to participate in murdering all of these Russian partisans.
So what did you do?
Well, when I heard this sort of thing, you see, they weren't just ordinary Russian partisans. Among them must have been my 8 guys that I pulled out that I saved. They were already my people. People I was responsible for. I felt that they were my people. And what I did, the stupidest thing ever I did in my life, truly the stupidest thing. I left the whole thing. I didn't clean the cauldron. I ran like the devil was chasing me, caught the first horse in the field, mounted that horse, went into the forest, and I thought like this, I will never find the partisans, but they will find me. And when I dismounted the horse, the minute I dismounted, I didn't even have a chance to look for anybody. I felt the gun in my back. And thank God something made me speak Russian instead of German or any other language. And I say, don't shoot, не стреляй, я еврейка, don't shoot, I am a Jewish girl, you are surrounded, run. And he disappeared. By the time I got, it started raining. By the time I got my horse and wanted to leave the forest was filled with Ukrainian police and Germans. And they came up to me, and the Ukrainian says, what I was doing here. And I started to cry, and I say, my father beats me, the horse ran away, I didn't milk my cows. And I was hitting the horse. I said, that stupid horse is going to get me into trouble. And I was crying. I was petrified. And I was blaming it on the horse. And I say, I don't know how I can get the cows now. They're all in the field, and it's raining. And the German said, was sagst du noch? What is she saying? And finally, the Ukrainian realized, that's a stupid village girl. And they let me go. What can I say? I took the horse into the barn. I washed them down and cleaned them off. And this is the first time I saw a horse cry. You know, horses cry. I hugged them and I said, I'm sorry if I hit you. I just had to blame somebody because I was so frightened. But the partisans escaped. It was very shortly, but maybe a month later, was in the month of November when the village was liberated by the Russians. And I was with the cows when one of the boys came and said, they are looking for you. I say, who? He says, the Russians. And he was so petrified. He says, maybe you should hide. I say, no. What happened? Oh, by the way, during that period of time I was in the village, one day I was out with the cows. I saw a head going up and down the rows of the potatoes. A straw head going down and pulling the potatoes. And I said to myself, who could be stealing potatoes? Or Jews or partisans? So after this head disappeared, I took all the potato stalks and I put them right back into the earth because I was afraid, you know, the farmer sees somebody was stealing his potatoes, they will go to the Germans before you know it. It's trouble, so I put them all back. Well, anyway, Later on, I found out it was one of the partisans stealing the potatoes.
So now talking about liberation.
Yes, so they brought me, they asked me to go and didn't make a fuss because, after all, the Russians are not going to kill me. They brought me to the school, the same school where they had this kitchen. And I walked in there, and they were sitting there, and this boy who brought, this soldier who brought me there, didn't have epaulets. I didn't know if he was an officer. He was just wearing a regular Russian uniform. And they said, "Is this the girl?" One of the high-ranking officers, and he said, "Yes." And then the joy started. They slapped me on the back, and of course everything hurt me. And they declared, they were drinking a little bit. They were very jolly, and they smiled. "Yes, Jevushka, very brave girl." And they tell the whole story. I mean, among this boy who brought me was one of the guys I pulled out from that prison, and he was the one who was pulling these potatoes. They knew I was there in this village.
How did they know?
Well, they know that. When they described the girl who came to tell them that they are surrounded, they described me, and these boys recognized my, this must have been Evreka, that I was a Jewish girl.
So what did they do with you?
What did they do? They gave me a medal, they made me a hero of the Soviet Union, and then later on, now, this boy who brought me, he was a Jewish boy, his name was Kola Yarov, Kalman, it was his Hebrew name. His father, he brought me to his father later on, his father was a physician. You see, the first contingency of the Russian partisans, the Kolpak partisans, General-Major Kvashti Geroy, twice a year of the Soviet Union, the Kolpak, whose partisans are named after him, were totally destroyed because they didn't just fight in the forest, they went and sabotaged behind German lines.
Did you know that at the time?
No, I
found
that.
So going back to the time.
And then I found out later. The second Kolpaks, the second contingent of Kolpaks, were students from universities. Men, about 60% of them, were Jewish students who volunteered for this suicidal mission. Kola was a Jew, his father was a Jew, Yarov, quite a few of them were Jews. I didn't know that. I found out later.
So going back to your own life.
Okay, so they gave me these papers, and well, I asked him to find me a ride that I was going back to Buchach. And so I came back to Buchach, and then there were very few survivors there. Most of the people who survived the first time were betrayed the second time, did not survive the second time. Out of about 6,000 children from my hometown, only 5 children that I know of survived. 4 are in Israel, and I'm here. There were other children, perhaps, who came in from other parts of the ghetto, but I didn't know that. Only the children that I knew personally before the war. One of the girls lived in Jerusalem, and I was friends with her sister.
Did you? You already knew that none of your family members?
Yes. So the first thing I did, I arranged with a man there, a Jewish man, to find my mother and bring her to Kever Yisrael. Kathy, I went to the house. I found the woman who betrayed me. My mother was buried there in a shallow grave. We put her in a wheelbarrow. We brought her to Kever Yisrael. And I was facing my mother's murderer. It was the worst time in my life. I was angry. I was furious. And yet, I couldn't really do anything to her. You see, she reached a kind of level of the lowest form of life. I didn't want to kill her. I didn't want to do anything to her because to kill her, I would have to become a murderer to this lowest form of life, and I didn't want to be a murderer to this lowest form of life.
So she had given you
up? She told me where my mother was, and she was petrified. She was sure that I was going to kill her or bring her to the police or tell the police of the crime she committed, that she sent the Germans on us. And but then from then that day on, I started spending most of my time on the cemetery. There was my mother buried, there was my brother Zachary, there was Rachel buried, my friend Rachel, and there was a grave I didn't know, but it was so close. So I used to put leaves or flowers on there, and that grave turned out to be Milek's. After the war, Milek came back to Buchach, and he and his friend Benjamin went to the library to take out books on biology. Miller still wanted to become a physician. And on the way back, they stepped on the bridge. There was a live mine. They stepped on that mine. The mine exploded. Milik was killed instantly, and Benjamin lost half of his leg. And I found out about Milik, Benjamin. Bella survived with Danny, and she asked me to go and talk to Benjamin because he lost half of his leg. And could I play chess with him? He was very depressed. And he was he had a little library with some books, and he had a biology book open there, and I was wondering why he would study biology. Does he want to be a doctor? And he told me about his friend Milik, and this is how I connected found out about Milik. And that was devastating. Anyway.
You were in love with him.
Very much so. I loved him since the age of 5. He gave me one kiss on the cheek and gave me this ring. But I loved Milik all my life, and I knew that my destiny will be, my future is going to be with Milik. We are both going to be physicians, and we are going to serve humanity.
We're going into the next tape now. Thank you. Alicia Appleman, you were telling me how through Benjamin you found out that the next grave was Milik's grave.
And then I knew what happened to him, and I thought that if there was a hero among us, he was one of the greatest. But I had to leave. Bella asked me that I had to leave because I was spending most of my time taking her son at the cemetery. We're just spending time there. So I left Poland, this part of Poland, and I went to Western Poland because at this point I decided I would have to leave Europe altogether, and I would probably go to Eretz Israel, to Palestine, what was known then, because we were Zionists and I could never live on a continent which was considered like a cemetery of my people. I still didn't know what happened to the rest of the Jewish people in Europe. My father was a partner in a factory in Bielsko, which was Western Poland. So I thought I would see my father's factory. I went there, and while I was living in Bielsko, I found children on the streets. And the way they looked, they were not ordinary children. The way they walked, the way they were dressed. And I found that they were Jewish children. Most of them were in concentration camps. Some of them were hidden. And I organized them. About 28 of them would be opened like a little orphanage. We were helped by the Jews from the Russian army. They helped us get food. I was with them, and this is the place where we children helped each other to trust people again, especially adults. We were healing each other through trust. At that particular time, I was getting a lot of clothing from the Russian Jews, and they were getting them from abandoned homes, and I was selling them to some of the survivors who came from Lodz, from the city of Lodz, L-O-D-Z. And then one day, I was only 15 years old, and I was doing all this business and selling them these things, and they said, where was I getting clothes from? And I say, the Russians are helping me because I helped them. And then I was just 15 years old, and I showed them my documents that the partisans gave me and the medal and everything. And they were just joking and very impressed. But then one day they came and they bought the stuff from me, and they said that there is a woman in Lodz by the name of Sivia who wants to see me. I was curious. I mean, and she, they told me how brave she was, that she was a hero from the Warsaw Ghetto. They built her up, and I fell in love with her before I even knew, because a heroic woman like that was somebody that I would do anything for. So I came to Lodz, and she engaged me in her organization, which was Bricha, a smuggling organization that was smuggling Jews out of Poland through Bratislava, Czechoslovakia, Hungary, then to Austria, and then into the occupied area that occupied by the Americans.
And what was her name, her full name?
Her name was Tsivia at the time. I didn't know her last name. I found out her name was Tsivia Lobatkin. Only now I know, but to me she was Tsivia. And because of these documents, I was able to go in and buy documents for us, for the people. I had 33 people in each time in the group. And at the beginning, I was learning with another girl, but then I was taking them independently. I was so good at smuggling the people out that they gave me deserters, Jewish deserters from the Russian army. And I smuggled them out. And then one time I got ill, and I had to stop smuggling. I got problems with my lungs. I had tuberculosis during the war, and I lost the use of one of my lungs. So I stayed in Austria, in Bad Gastein, in a very nice place, which was very good for my lungs. And that was 1945, 1946. And in 1946, those who were in this organization of the Bricha were promised papers to go to Israel, but I had to give up my papers for somebody who was more important, the legal papers. So we were going to Belgium and meet up with the Jewish brigade who fought with the British, go on their ship to Israel.
So before Palestine. You continue, do you still have your medal of heroism?
Yes. I didn't have my medal. What happened, what I did with my medal and my papers, when I got ill, I sent them back to Lodz to be used. Another girl could use them because it didn't have my picture. Now, my medal and my papers came eventually to Israel with somebody who came to Gush Etzion, but Gush Etzion was overrun by the Jordanians in the War of Independence, so I lost that. But if I were now to write to President Yeltsin and tell him, he would look up the history of the Kolpak partisans, he would find my name, not under Alicia, but Anusha Jurman, that gave me a new name, and he would probably give me back the medal and the papers and probably give me a pension. But you see, I don't have that relationship with the Russians.
So going back to your, continuing your story.
And then from Belgium, I was in Belgium in 46, and then I went to a school, to an orphanage there in Marquen. And in the spring of 47, all the 600 boys and girls, mostly survivors of camps from Czechoslovakia and Hungary, I was the only Polish girl survivor, were brought on an illegal ship, were brought to France, put on an illegal ship called the Theodor Herzl, and we were sailing for Israel in the spring of 1947. Unfortunately, our ship was leaking, and instead of going like for 6 days, we had about several weeks of very hard pumping and sailing. We finally got to Israel. We were captured by the British. We fought with the British for 2 hours. We threw all the garbage we collected for them, but then finally they threw tear gas into our ship, and they boarded us, and they took their vengeance because quite a few children were thrown overboard, were clobbered over the head. I have pictures of coffins taken off my ship.
What was the name of your ship?
Theodor Herzl. And then I was taken with all of the other people to Cyprus, where I spent 8 months in a camp, a youth camp.
What date were you taken
from
there?
From March until December.
Of which year?
1947. In December, Golda Meir did come to Cyprus, and she took 1,000 children out of there, and I was one of the 1,000. And then I came to Israel, and I went to a youth aliyah school called Mikve Yisrael. Mikve Yisrael is located between Tel Aviv and Hulon. And I was there for my senior high school year to finish my studies because I was going to school in Belgium and I was going to school in Cyprus. The 8 months we were studying a lot. Then the War of Independence started. And while I was in Cyprus, we were trained by the Palmach. And then when I was in Cyprus, we had combat duties. We fought in Abu Kabir and Tel Arish, and then in the capture of Jaffa. Our class, a whole class of 32 kids went in to fight. We had to get into Jaffa. And luckily, we had the Eitzel helping us, who were very, very well-trained soldiers. And then after we captured Jaffa, I was moved to the headquarters of the Israeli Navy, and I worked as a welfare officer in the Israeli Navy for the remaining of my 2 years in the Israeli Navy. I met an American by the name of Gabriel Appleman, who came to help us save our lives. We were married in 1950, and because his father was ill, he had a brain tumor operation. He brought me to the United States in 1952.
Could you describe what it felt like to be living in Israel?
At that time, for me, it was very, very important. The war was going on, but you must understand, Kathy, I had the chance to go to the United States because young teenagers were registered to go and be adopted by some families in the United States. And my friend registered me. But I knew whatever was going to happen after the war, I knew that the people in Palestine, my people are going to fight for their lives. My destiny is with them. And so I knew that this is one time, even though during the war, I was able to fight against the Germans in a way I knew how, by saving lives. I knew that I will be able to be a combat soldier for my land, and if I have to die, I will die. But I will be able to fight, at least I will have a chance. And so I was not afraid at all.
So you come to the United States?
We came to the United States to help my father-in-law.
What day?
Became October 1952. My husband went first, and then I got my papers, and I came October 1952. It was cold, very cold here. I remember I came from Israel. It was warm there. And we came for a little while.
To what city?
To Brooklyn, to Flatbush. And we thought we'll stay here a few years, help Papa, and then we'll go back to Israel because that was my homeland. But Papa never got well, and my husband was the oldest son, and it was just proper for us to stay. Then I discovered that I had difficulties in having children because the typhoid that I had and typhus infected the reproductive organs, especially the fallopian tube through which the egg has to travel to get fertilized. And so I started going to a fertility and sterility doctor, to Dr. Weissman in New York, and it took me about 5 years, and through a miracle, our son Daniel was born at December 11, 1958. And that was just really a miracle. And they had published a whole article in the Parade magazine because it was a medical miracle that I had a child.
And how many children do you have today?
We have two sons and a daughter, Daniel, firstborn, and then Zachary, and then Ronit, and then Zachary. And we have two granddaughters, Maya and Kendra. Maya is 9 and Kendra is 6.
And how long have you been in the United States?
I have been in the United States since 1952. From 1969 to 1975, our family lived in Israel, so I was there during the Yom Kippur War. And I'm sorry there was a Yom Kippur War, but I was very glad that I was there because at least I didn't have to worry myself to death. Being there, I could help and do whatever I could. So I lived in Israel a total of 11 years of my life. And you know, Kathy, I'm like a woman with two husbands. I love Israel passionately, and I love the United States passionately. I love both countries, and I'm very fortunate that they are wonderful friends. Because I love both countries very, very much.
And what how did you finish your education?
And I have been like what you would call a perennial student. I always go to school. I love going to school. I have many credits. If I put them all together, I'll probably have a couple of doctorates. I've been just for years and years. And I have been a speaker since I promised my brother that if I lived, I will tell his story. I have been a speaker since I was able to master this complicated English language. When I was telling my story, it was very early. It was in the 50s and in the 60s. It was very difficult for people to understand what I was saying. But since I promised that I will, and I did. And I took my story eventually to the schools to tell it to the children, to the students. They, in turn, urged me each time, say, Alicia, if you could only write this story down, our parents would love to read it. So in 1982, the opportunity came when my husband's company moved us to Holland. So I sat from 1982 to 1985, and I wrote this book called Alicia, My Story. In this book, I recorded all I have told you and much, much more. It has been received with great love by the students from fifth grade to university students by their parents. I speak all over the country in Canada.
Could I ask you, what did you feel the day you finished writing your story?
When I finished writing my story, I realized something very important, and I said it to my husband. Gabriel, I don't feel guilty anymore for surviving. Many of us, and I can speak for myself, not that I could have helped it, that I survived, but I always felt that if anybody deserved to survive in my family or was destined to survive, it should have been my brother Zachary and not I. And so I felt very guilty. But after I finished writing this book, I realized that even if I didn't survive, my brother Zachary still would not have survived because he chose to fight back. He chose to endanger himself every day. He chose to give his life to save other people. This was his destiny. And I was, you know what I said? My God. And I was stunned by the things this young girl, Alicia, did. I said, what a girl. I just caught my head and I said, what a girl. Even I did not realize fully, even telling my story, after 3 years, it took me 3 years to write this book, I relived every moment of what happened with great intensity, with a lot of tears. And then I said, God, there should never, ever be a girl like Alicia. Nobody should ever have to testify to this kind of hell and to this kind of tragedy. But I don't feel guilty, but it served in a case of catharsis. But what I do feel very humble, that I was able to be the voice of these very brave children.
How has all this experience affected you in the way you brought up your children?
I told my children, if you have dirty rooms, I can perhaps understand it, I will close the door. If your grades are not up to A, I will not be very happy, but I can understand. But one thing I shall never ever tolerate is any remark of people about people's religion or people's race. This I shall never tolerate. People are who they are. They are born into communities that they are born in. They have to be respected. People should be regarded for their own self-worth, for their behavior, and not what religion they belong to. And I must say with humility that my children are good people. They care about others. They have been big brothers. They take care of people. And this is all I can really ask from the good Lord.
And what message would you like to give your children and your grandchildren?
I would like to tell my children that they have a heritage of a very proud people, that they are what they are, they should be proud who they are, they should communicate with others, give others respect, and make sure that every person at all times in their lives protect other people's human rights. We have to be our brother's keeper. We have to care. We have to care about the little Mexican children, that they should have doctor's cares, that they should have a good life. no matter how their parents brought them here, they are children who should be protected. Children should be protected at all times, anywhere in the world, and should be held because they are always the first victims whenever a war starts. As to you, dear listener, I want you to know that there were many brave children who maintained their belief in God, but in their dignity. They died, but they never ever let the Germans destroy their soul. I would like to have this opportunity to read to you the last message in my book. I believe that this book will teach young people what enormous reserves of strength they possess within themselves. I pray that all its readers, Jew and non-Jew alike, may unite in the resolve that evil forces will never again be permitted to set one people against another.
Thank you very much.
Thank you very much, Kathy. I would like to thank this organization of the Shoah under the leadership of Mr. Spielberg for giving us an opportunity to tell our stories and to you generations of the future. I have learned from the past three generations how splendid you are, how understanding you are, how much compassion you are. And I thank you for taking us, the children from this tragic world, into your heart. And I hope the generations of the future will do the same.
Thank you. Thank you for your story.
Thank you very much, darling.
Thank you. Mrs. Appleman, would you please introduce me to your husband?
This is Gabriel Appleman.
That's me.
Mr. Appleman, what has it been like to be married to a survivor?
Well, it's an experience which a few others have had. I was not a survivor myself. I did not live through the Holocaust. I met my wife in Israel when during a period where nobody really wanted to talk very much about it, and I don't think I really understood fully just what had happened in Europe until quite a few years later. Of course, it's a little difficult, you know. She used to wake up screaming at night, and I never could understand quite why. And it made it. I guess, you know, you run into this. It could have been me, sort of psychology.
And what would you like to tell her now?
Tell her now?
Yes.
Well, I don't know. It's a long time. You know, we've been married an awful lot of years. What could I tell her now that I'm still here for her? And she's trying to help people remember so that when we're both gone, people don't forget about all this, which is important, I suppose, because most American Jews during World War II didn't really understand what was going on. And I understand that some of our leaders knew, but the great mass didn't. I certainly didn't. We didn't know in the army, and we didn't know even right immediately after the war. I remember seeing streams and streams of refugees after the fighting ended, and it never occurred to me to wonder whether any of them were Jewish or any of them were not Jewish. And they all spoke strange languages, and they had their push carts and their trucks and trying to find some place to live.
And to finish, what would you like to say to her? Just in one sentence.
Chazak ve'ematz.
Which means?
To go from strength to strength.
That's right.
Can I say something to him?
No.
I want to thank you, Gabriel, for bearing our anguish and for editing my book and for supporting me now when I'm beginning to travel again and for just being there for me. Thank you so much. Thank you, Miss Kathy. You are just a wonderful lady. Truly wonderful, sweetheart.
Are they going to leave this in
Thank you. Thank you very much. Yes, thank you for introducing me to your family.
Thank you very much, dear heart. And I would like to thank Raul, and I would like to thank Dorothy. And everybody.
Okay. Thank you.
Everybody. This photo was taken in 1985. From right to left is my husband, Gabriel Appleman, and then I'm Alicia Appleman, and then there is Danielle Appleman, our son, our daughter, Ronit Appleman, and now she is Rowan Bear, Eric Peterson, and our youngest son, Zachary Appleman. The photo was taken in 1985 in the city of Santa Cruz.
Thank you.
Our two granddaughters, from right to left, is Maya, and the little one is Kendra. This picture was taken in 1993. I call them the Barefoot Contessas. I made their dresses, and I just really think they look cute.
Where was the picture taken?
It was taken in Santa Cruz.
And the last name?
Their names are Maya and Kendra Peterson.
Thank you.
Thank you. The book Alicia won the 1989 Christopher Award. Christopher Award is given each year to recognize the creative writers, producers, and directors who have achieved artistic excellence in film, books, and television. It's affirming the highest values of the human spirit. Alicia also won the Lycra Award, the French Award for heroism, given by the Ministry of Human Action. Alicia, my story was translated in 8 languages in Europe and is read all over the world.